Donald Trump is demanding Boeing make a cheaper Air Force One. I don't know about you, but I'm all for cutting corners on any airplane Donald Trump is flying on. It's 3 a.m. Tuesday, February 21st. Today's show is brought to you by you, the listener. On today's program, Andy Kindler, Negin Farsad, Angela Cobb, and my old friend, Jon Ross. Stay with us. We've got a lot of show.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
I love Bill Maher. I worked for Bill Maher for a very long time. I worked for him. I had been working for Dennis Miller for a very long time, and Dennis was for the war in Iraq, and I started working for Bill, and it was a very exciting time in my life because Bill was the only one who was questioning the George W. Bush administration and the war, which was illegal. And it was dangerous, and he was brave, and working on real time was the best job I ever had. And the biggest mistake I ever made was leaving to go work for the union busting John Stewart. Biggest mistake. Best job, best writing staff. It was a think tank. All that being said, I watched real time last weekend. I watched Overtime with, I won't even mention his name, with the Breitbart editor who is British and is flamboyantly gay and trashes Muslims, transgender people, Leslie Jones. People should watch Real Time with Bill Maher because it's a great show. And Bill is incredibly brave. But shame on you, Bill, for having him on your show, for normalizing a sociopath right out of the Nazi playbook. I'm watching him, and it's like a character from Cabaret. Shame on you for putting him on. He is far more dangerous than Ann Coulter. And here's my, and then I'm going to shut up about this, but this is what really irritated me, because I watched a little of it, and then my stomach turned. At one point, this guy said that transgender people are guilty of sex crimes. That statistically speaking, transgender people are more likely to commit sex crimes than any other group of people. This was a conversation about what goes on in bathrooms and why transgender people should be banned from certain types of bathrooms. And then Larry Wilmore said, well, let's see a stat. And that just breezed by everybody. And now it's been planted in people's heads that transgender people are more likely to molest your children, which is not true, than anybody else. That is the danger of doing a clusterfuck show live with no fact-checking. And that is the danger of having an inveterate liar on your show who is a page out of Cabaret. So shame on you. And finally, and then I'll start what people really want to hear. As a Jew who was bar mitzvahed, as somebody who was raised Jewish and became a Jew out of choice, because I was raised in a secular family, my parents couldn't care less. I chose to go to an Orthodox temple because my parents took their Judaism for granted. When your Nazi guest, your gay Nazi guest from Breitbart, and you identify as Jewish, I am deeply offended, and I want you to stop. Bill Maher, who I love, was raised Catholic. Just because your mother is Jewish, it doesn't mean that you are Jewish. You were raised Catholic. You weren't bar mitzvahed. You didn't go to temple. And whenever you're in trouble, Bill Maher, you always say, well, I'm a Jew. I'm a Jew. You're not. We don't need you. We don't need you trashing Muslims on your show. And then when you get into trouble, identify as a Jew. That's not what Jews do. So stop identifying as a Jew. We've got enough problems controlling the banks and the media. We don't need you representing us. And the same thing goes for your flamboyantly gay guest. You were raised Catholic. You weren't raised Jewish. You have a maternal grandmother or grandfather who might have been Jewish. And when you're in trouble, you identify as being Jewish. And you also identify as gay, and the gay people don't need you. I can't, you know, I don't speak for the gay people. I can't stop this Milo Yiannopoulos from either being a bottom or a top. But as a Jew, you're not a Jew. You weren't bar mitzvahed. You didn't go to Hebrew school. You have a maternal grandmother. You have a maternal grandmother who was Jewish, maybe. The same way Hitler may have had some Judaism in his blood. Don't identify as a Jew. You're not Jewish. You don't represent our values. The reason the mother, if the mother's Jewish, the kid is considered Jewish, even though they weren't raised Jewish or bar mitzvahed, is because of rape. That's why. It's because of rape. The Jewish people will accept you if your mother's Jewish and she was raped by somebody. So you raise the kid as a Jew. He's accepted into the tribe. That's the only reason you're identified as a Jew if your mother's a Jew, but you weren't raised Jewish. Bill Maher, you're not a Jew. You don't reflect Jewish values. And the Nazi you had on your show does not represent Jewish values. Don't fall back on being a Jew whenever you get into trouble. Hi. Welcome. Sorry.
You know, it's always a fun podcast when it starts on a note of rape.
Hi.
I'm sorry. I'm taking out a pen so I could take some notes. Hello.
Hi. Negin Farsad.
Hello.
Has been on my show before.
I have. I've been in this very room, but without you.
With Colleen.
Yeah.
And that was, you see, you're lucky.
That was great. Because she's great.
Yes. You're in trouble. This is just going to be.
This is just going to suck.
This is going to suck. Negin Farsad is the host of Fake the Nation. I was just on it. I had a fantastic time.
Yeah, we had so much fun having you.
She is also the author of a book, How to Make White People Laugh, and a movie called The Muslims Are Coming.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for coming on my show. Tell me about Muslims Are Coming. It's a movie, right?
Yeah, well, what we did is we took a bunch of like Muslim comedians and took them on the road to places like Mississippi and Alabama and Arizona, whatever places that have total boners for Muslims. And we did these shows, right? And we called them The Muslims Are Coming. And then we also like in between shows, we would do street actions. Like we would stop people in the middle of their day and have them, you know, we would set up an Ask a Muslim booth and be like, ask mm-hmm. us any questions, whatever. And like just a bunch of different like fun things. We also interviewed, speaking of Jews, a whole bunch of like amazing Jewish comedians like Jon Stewart, mm-hmm. Who you mentioned earlier. I'm in a less than positive light. And, you know,
I love Jon. He's just anti-union.
No, I got you. We had on people like Jon Stewart and David Cross and Louis Black and Janine Garofalo and you know, some others talking about like the hilariousness of Islamophobia, which mm-hmm. is a real hoot. And in that movie, you know, it's like available on your iTunes and your Amazons and right. whatever. But yeah, so I sort of like do that kind of, that's what is one of the things I do as a comic is just try to do this like kind of bridge building, which is why I join you in the frustration over Bill Maher. I mean, can I ask you a question about sure. your experience with sure. him? What did he ever like do the ranting about Muslims when you worked for him?
No.
Is this just no. like a more like last few years development?
Yeah. And there's like, I don't watch the show. Once I leave a show, I don't watch it.
Mm-hmm.
Or once I don't even watch the show.
No, it's like seeing an ex-boyfriend. You yeah. don't want to do that. Yeah, yeah, I get you.
Or I don't. Anyway, so I think there's a screw loose.
Mm.
Anti-Semitism, which includes Islamophobia, Semites.
Right.
It's the same thing. I'm not being glib.
Yeah, yeah. Technically it is, yeah.
Technically it is. Although
people don't see it that way or understand it that way, but
especially
yeah.
the Semites.
Yeah.
That's, you know, there's an interesting theory about that. I'll write. Let me just make a note. The New Yorker article that I read 22 years ago about.
Jesus.
I know.
You remember a New Yorker article you read 22 years
yeah,
ago?
Yeah,
that's
it
pretty
was
phenomenal.
Illustrative of the squabbling between Jews and Muslims, which is not, by the way, when people say, you know, we can't get involved in Israel. This is a fight that has gone on for millennium.
Mm-hmm.
Shut the F up. It's a fight that's been going on for maybe 70 years,
yeah.
50 years.
Yeah, yeah.
The Muslims and the Jews got along very well, and especially in Spain. So read your history. So anyway, no, Bill has a screw loose when it comes to Islamophobia. It's a sickness. Islamophobia is a mental illness. No, you're laughing.
No, I like that. Yeah.
No, it is.
Yeah.
It really is.
Yeah.
It's a need to explain your situation, the same way anti-Semitism or racism is a sickness, because you have an identity issue with racism, and it's an identity crisis that you're having, and an ignorant way to explain your situation and the world situation. So no, he never ranted against any group of people. He's, for all intents, is a progressive, as I remember. I don't think he's ever been afraid because of who he is.
Mm. Right. The interesting thing about his rantings is that they're like fundamentally baseless, because he'll make the exact same argument. I mean, he'll make the opposite argument, you know, for, you know, it's like he likes to say there's something fundamentally wrong with Muslims or like with Islam, and Islam's the problem.
Mm-hmm.
But if you said that to him, you know, about, like, let's say black people or Mexicans, he would lose his mind and think that you were crazy.
Right.
Like, if I said there's fundamentally something wrong with, like, Mexican culture, like, he would be punching me in the face. Like,
right.
That would be out of control. So he doesn't see the compartmentalizing that he's doing in order to keep these arguments, you know, together in his own head. And it's the oddest thing. And he is such a huge platform, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I think, you know, in one sense, having a guy like Milo Yiannopoulos,
yeah,
or whatever the fuck, some ways I'm like, oh, well, I understand, you know, where progressives are insulated from a lot of these ideas, and it's good to hear what the other side is thinking. And a guy like Milo, you know, I was saying before, he's like 20% handsome. So you know, he's got an accent, right? So you sort of like don't mind hearing from him in a weird way. But, you know, I think a lot of those weird alt-right but British people like have that going for them. But so in some sense, I'm like, okay, well, we should be hearing what they're talking about.
Why?
But because to know what ideology like we're actually dealing with. You know, I don't, you know, sometimes you, especially if you're living in, I don't know, Madison, Wisconsin, or New York City, or like these liberal enclaves where everything is great and you can order hemp milk with your coffee, you know, that when you're living in places like this, I think you're sometimes, you know, a little bit insulated from some of the ideologies that are taking hold in other parts of the country. And so it's sometimes good to hear that. But at the same time, now I will contradict myself. At the same time, I wonder if, you know, he's just giving them a platform and it's popularizing those ideas. And that's what's so dangerous about it. And, you know, it's interesting. I interviewed Rachel Maddow for The Muslims Are Coming. And I don't remember if this made it into the film, but she talked about her struggle as a broadcaster in wanting to tell people about, for example, the American Family Association, that, you know, they have a TV show, they have a radio show, they're mm-hmm. out there every day advocating against Muslims and advocating against, that doesn't make sense. Anyway, but they're out there talking smack about Muslims and gays, by the way. They hate the gays. And they do it, and they're listed as a hate group by the Southern Poverty Law Center. And they're out there all the time doing it. And she, for a time when they had lots of money and they were doing this a lot, you know, she would report on it. But then at a certain time, she just had to kind of pull back and say, am I giving them a platform? Am I just reinforcing the underlying hateful message by giving them a platform? And that's a problem, you know? Now we're dealing with a situation where we know that this is not these are not niche-like opinions, because like 39%, you know, Trump has a 39% approval rating, about 39% of the public really loves what he's saying and doing. So they're not like fringe ideology. So it is something we need to like report on. But yeah, it's like a big question how to deal with it.
Yeah, I'll tell you how to deal with it.
All right.
Here's how you deal with it. You ignore them. You don't dignify them. You don't give them a mouthpiece. What you do is you focus on the 530 representatives in government. You focus on your state legislature. Mm-hmm. You focus on your police. You focus on your government. Because what we're going to see, assuming things play out,
uh-huh,
Donald Trump is going to rev up the racists,
mm-hmm,
and he's going to get people stoked and fired up. And that public opinion of Islamophobia, anti-Semitism, anti-gay, that'll go up and down, up and down. Washington, D.C. and the state legislatures and your mayors don't dignify that if you focus on your lawmakers. We are not a nation of the vast majority of Americans can hate gays, Jews, women, blacks, Muslims. It doesn't matter as long as Congress and the Senate and the president and the judges don't.
Mm-hmm.
So for Bill Maher, who's reaching millions of people on HBO, to introduce a fringe crackpot,
right,
and elevate him into the discussion, it's a waste of time.
Right.
We don't need to hear what he has to say. And the Bill Maher show and a college campus is not the forum to present a lunatic.
Mm.
The problem with the Bill Maher show is that's your dessert. That's fun. To have a live show where it's the audience cheering and booing, and you win by how the audience reacts, that's not education. That's not informing people. And what happened was Larry Wilmore was on, and he told Milo Yiannopoulos to go F himself, mm-hmm, and the audience cheered. because it was partisan.
Right.
And I'm thinking, well, you just lost.
Yeah.
You just hurt my cause and your cause by saying go F yourself and getting angry without challenging him on facts and stats. The Bill Maher Show is not the forum to put a neo-Nazi white supremacist on, because it's a gangbang. It's four people screaming and yelling to try to get their point. You want to have Milo on? Do it without an audience. So there's no cheering.
Yeah.
Interview him.
Yeah. I think, and you know, the other thing I'd say you're right about that. And just in defense of not having him on at all, I think one of the things that we're seeing right now is like this crazy increase in national anxiety, just actual physical pangs that people feel. I go to acupuncture, not to brag.
Yes.
And I went to the other day and I go to one of these like community acupuncture places or whatever. So you're like right next to a bunch of people getting acupuncture. And I overheard this guy like lay down and the woman, you know, says like, what's your problem? And he says, I have so much anxiety. I mean, I know this sounds crazy, but it's probably just Trump related anxiety, but like, I just need to calm down. And she was like, oh, literally 80% of the patients here have that problem.
Right.
And so it's like, all over the place, there's this anxiety that's created, and the trickling out of this kind of rhetoric on shows like Bill Maher is not like helping. You know, I think
right. The
other thing is
it's making money for Bill. Bill's very rich.
We're watching a train wreck, and everyone enjoys that. But it's not offering solutions,
right.
And it's not offering any kind of like morale boosting.
Right.
Like you never like walk out of watching something like that and like, I feel great about the Republic. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
So I feel like that's another argument for not having these fuckers on.
It's turning up the heat.
Yeah.
Because heat makes money. Bill gets rich. You know, he gave $1 million to Barack Obama. I think he owns the Mets. I don't watch the show, and I don't know. You know, I love his writers. But he's a very wealthy man.
Yeah.
And HBO is a very profitable
entity,
company.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you make money by turning up the heat under the shield of the First Amendment.
Yeah.
Freedom of speech. Hey, freedom of speech. Can't we have rational discourse? How about you inform? How many masters do you have?
I have two master's
degrees.
What
are they in?
I have a master's in public policy from the School of International and Public Affairs at Columbia. And I have another one in African-American studies. And I was focusing on, race relations.
Where did you get that?
Also at Columbia. So
okay.
I did both of them at the same time.
I'm not going to ask you, what kind of family you came from. Is that expensive to get? Let's just assume.
Yeah.
Let me be. Just not talking about you, but as somebody who's uneducated compared to you, but I want to feel patronizing and, as a parent who put a daughter through college and made sure she got two masters from Columbia. Is that expensive?
I mean,
yes, it is. The answer is yes.
It is.
So that's why.
fellowships and stuff like that. So it's not like I had some finances worked out through that.
If I'm sending my kid to Columbia to get two masters, I don't want her to go see Milo Yiannopoulos speak at Berkeley. My daughter went to Berkeley.
Right.
Hey, you know what? Go see a professor. I don't want her seeing Jerry Seinfeld or Chris Rock, who are complaining now about how politically correct
campuses are.
Yeah. You know what? Jerry and Chris, you can go sell out an amphitheater. Stay off my daughter's college campus. I don't want her seeing comedians.
Right.
I don't want her seeing Bon Jovi. I want her studying and listening to professors. It's one of the biggest scams going on college campuses is that I remember the story of George Carlin being paid something like $75,000 to play a college campus 30 years ago.
Jesus, the kid I'm getting underpaid.
And the kid handing him the check says, this is more than my house is worth that I grew up in. You know what? Go see George Carlin. I love George Carlin. Go see him at the Circle Star Theater. Don't come to my kid's college campus and suck up all the money. Sorry.
Well, so, you know, what's interesting is when I was at Columbia, Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, the former president of Iran, came to speak.
Right.
And there were protests and everyone got pissed.
He's not a comedian.
No, he was a world leader at the time. And but it was interesting because this exact kind of conversation erupted around, is this the university tacitly, you know, accepting his...
No, he deserves to speak. You know, he has some legitimate thoughts about the Holocaust being and Israel. But no,
my favorite of his is, we do not have gay people in Iran. I don't know who told you that. I think he like literally said that on the Columbia campus.
He was the mayor of Tehran, mm-hmm. I believe. And then he became the president of Iran.
Yeah.
He deserves to speak at Columbia. Hitler should be allowed to speak at Columbia. Hitler should be allowed on, well, you know, the Bill Maher show. I think the problem with the Bill Maher show is it's blood and circus. It's the Colosseum. It's the audience screaming, and that you don't. I've never been to a college lecture where the students are cheering and screaming. Well, there was a guy named James Shenton. He was a professor I had who used to get the audience cheering. But if you're going to learn, the students need to shut up and listen and learn. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, I did. That was it.
So they don't belong on our college campuses. Nobody belongs on our college campuses other than professors.
Yeah, I think there's room. I mean, you know, you have to think about, like, a lot of these are liberal arts colleges, and they are giving you a well-rounded education, and art and activism is a part of that education. And so, you know, I can understand, I can see how someone like George Carlin is a part of that discourse.
No,
you know?
George Carlin's the best comic who ever did it. He doesn't belong on a college campus. You're there to educate. You pick a college based on the curriculum, the classes, and the professors. They're so busy building buildings that they can't pay the adjunct professors. Pay your professors properly. What's the point of having PhD? What's the point of swimming in PhDs if you're not going to use what you got?
Well, maybe I'm defensive about this because I perform at a lot of colleges.
Well, there you go. And that's the problem. There you go. And people keep their mouths shut because they don't want to cut off their source of income.
No. But I think...
But you have two masters.
And what I try and do... I mean, I'm like a little bit... Not to put myself in a separate category, but I am like... I'm like a little bit more of a message-oriented comic. And I feel like that age group is really fertile in terms of like they're willing to listen to ideas that are maybe off the beaten path. You know, some of the best shows I've ever had were like at a college in South Dakota where they literally have never met a Muslim before, where they literally have never heard anyone say, hey, Muslims, they're okay, or like human rights, they're good. You know what I mean? Like that. That's these kind of really simple ideas about equality are not necessarily terribly popular in some of the places that I've performed. And I feel really gratified when I go and, you know, when these students ask me questions and when, you know, and sometimes there's, you know, they'll be like a 19-year-old, like Filipino American girl that's like, I feel like everything you're saying about your life is my life, you know, because they're just not hearing the experience of like a quote unquote otherized American, in their daily life. You know, they're generally not seeing it on television. They're generally not seeing it in film, right? They're definitely not seeing it on Fox News. And so to have access to that, to, you know, perspective on their college campus, I think is important to them, and like it means something to them. And so for that, I defend the practice of like bringing someone like me to
school. Well, of course you belong on a college campus. You're credentialed. What I object to is giving students what they want as opposed to what they need. I have a lot of friends, comedians, who just because they're young, they perform all over college campuses. I don't feel like paying to send my kid to a college campus, to college, to have uncredentialed people giving them pastry.
You know, Snoop Dogg performed at my college once when I was there.
So I don't condone that.
Right. Yeah.
I think Snoop is great. Or whatever he's, you know.
Yeah, whatever he's going by, yeah.
But that's not why you go to college. You can go see Snoop. You can get on a train or a bus and go see Snoop. The college campus should be the sole province of PhDs, people who are credentialed and are teaching. These kids are young. You know, just because you're 19 or 20 or 21, you're not allowed to drink until you're 21, which means you're a baby.
That still doesn't stop them. Did it stop you or did it stop me? I mean, obviously.
Well, we're going to live to 150. Mm. If people stop paying attention to Milo Yiannopoulos and they stop booking Jerry Seinfeld and Snoop at college campuses and people, you know, roll up their sleeves and get their education, we're going to live to 150.
Yeah.
You send an 18-year-old off to college in terms of geologic time, they're babies. Mm. They're babies.
Yeah.
They're not allowed to drink. You need to mold their minds. Don't give them what they want. And that's the whole problem with colleges now. You get a PhD in this country, a doctorate, and you can't make a living.
Mm.
Because the college campuses are swimming with alcohol and false prophets. Like Jerry Seinfeld, Chris Rock, Bon Jovi, George Carlin, and Snoop Dogg.
Is it you're like strangely fixated on Bon Jovi?
I don't know.
He's not on the college circuit in the way that you might think.
Sorry. All right. I'm filled with piss and vinegar.
Someone just paid a tuition bill.
Yeah. Well, anyway, Berkeley's a great campus. Mm. And they were right for not allowing Yiannopoulos on their campus.
Yeah. No, I mean, I just think it's good not to have someone on that's going to incite violence or, you know, that where there's some sort of danger of that. So there's just no point in that. It doesn't, you know, the ideas aren't valuable enough to merit that kind of danger. So like, what's the, you know,
idea that college students are adults is one of the great misconceptions in American history.
Anyone who's like 23 agrees with you, because it's like you look back at like those 4 years and you're like, I was a real idiot in so many ways.
Yeah. And if you have a son, your job is to keep your son alive until he's 23. They've done studies that sons, boys, have no concept of risk in their brain until they're 23, 24.
Jesus.
Which is why college boys are still skateboarding without helmets, that whole thing. And that's why you send boys off to war.
Yeah,
because they
have
no concept of risk.
Ugh. I was like, you know, I remember like someone was trying to get me to do they weren't like pressuring me to do drugs, but like it was, and I can't remember what it was. It was like some sort of pill.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just like, okay, we need to like weigh the positives and negatives, you know? And like, I mean, it was like a 45-minute deliberation on whether or not I would try this. I ultimately didn't try it because I was like, I'm scared of the, you know, the 5% chance that I could have like flashbacks or something into my future. So we're not going to do it. But yeah, I was extraordinarily risk averse.
Are you a Democrat?
Yeah.
Are you happy?
I was a Democrat. Sorry, everybody.
We're going to keep that in. Not that one.
I was a Democrat. I am a Democrat. I actually interned for Hillary Clinton and I interned for Charlie Rangel and, I'm more of a legit Democrat than a lot of people just from those experiences.
You interned for Charlie Rangel?
Yeah.
When we wrangle, we wrangle.
I did. And I was one of those people, you know, when they say call your congressional office and or don't call the D.C. office, like, you know, because there were people like me answering the call, and they would say, oh, I want, you know, Charlie to vote this way or that way on whatever. And then, like, someone like me or one of his staffers would, like, make a note of that. And then they would tally it. And, like, it was, they listened to constituent phone calls. So that's actually something I think people should really be doing.
It's really working, supposedly. I mean, the problem is, my side is just waking up to what the Tea Party got 8 years ago.
Yeah.
Are you optimistic about this left awakening that's going on?
I am. I mean, I don't know, like, if you've seen this in your friends, but it's just like, you know, I've done a lot of, like, the political stuff. I was a policy advisor for the city of New York, you know, so I went to my fair share of, like, demonstrations and rallies and protests and whatever. And that's not something that was alien to me. Like, it was, you know, something that I sort of did. But that I wouldn't, you know, it's not like I could ever convince a friend to go with me. You know what I mean? But now it just feels like everyone is doing the rallies and the protests, and they're just showing up. And everyone knows, like, everyone's texting about it. And it feels like something I've never seen before. You know, I never got that people were excited to show up in that way. It was always the kind of extreme, like, you know, patchouli scented set that would, like, show up to these things, and you'd be like, bless you guys, you know, because right. Otherwise it would just, you know, be us by ourselves. But now it feels like everyone's going, and it's becoming a little bit more of a social thing, you right. know? And, so that's great. It's funny because I don't know, except for the purchase of three cornered hats, if the Tea Party, like, had so much fun doing it. And I think that's the other interesting thing is, building social capital is something that we really actually need to focus on, which I think is what's happening right now. Like, people are building social allegiances based on going to protests and stuff like that. And there's this Harvard sociologist named Robert Putnam, who wrote a book called Bowling Alone. Mm-hmm. And in the book, he talked about the disintegration of social capital and, like, you know, and this was, like, in 2001. He was talking about, like, oh, there's no more 4-H club and whatever, and stuff like that, you know. And it's true. We don't have those kinds of institutions anymore. Like, people are not, fully invested in them. So you're not going into a town and, like, there isn't, like, a town dance or whatever, or, like, a town fair thing.
The problem,
you know,
is it's churches.
It's right. Yeah. And so it's not, there aren't these, like, secular gatherings that we kind of used to have. And so that means that the social capital that once worked through these, and the reason he called it Bowling Alone is because he was talking about the bowling leagues that we no longer have, the kind of mobility, the political mobilizing that kind of happened in these bowling leagues, like, is no longer a thing. And so that means, like, the civic engagement is fraying, you know, and it leads to, like, the growth of fringe ideologies. And we've seen that, right, with, like, crazy murders and, and the alt-right and all that shit. Right. So
can I just unpack,
please,
what you just said? Because it's really – just thank you for coming on the show. And I always apologize. I'm been reading a lot, and I'm angry. And I come from – I'm trying to deal with my anger.
Yeah.
But – and so
you're doing great.
Okay. I want to ask you about the Johnson Amendment.
Yes.
Okay. But I want to just – and I hate to use the word unpack, but what you're saying is, as I understand it, there was a time when we were small little communities who would gather together to help one another. Mm-hmm. So there, even bowling, we would bowl together. Mm-hmm. We would meet together and to discuss local issues. And then probably television ruined. Everybody just stayed home and watched television.
That was part of it. That was part of the thing that ruined it.
And Reagan and just self-determination and individualism.
Yeah.
Right? So when you're a politician, you want to go to a town where there's a built-in audience.
Mm-hmm.
Where can I go? Well, the only built-in audience left is a church.
Church.
So I want to ask you, what is the Johnson Amendment? Donald Trump wants to get it overturned. And would I be wrong for agreeing with Donald Trump for wanting to overturn the Johnson Amendment?
Right. So the Johnson Amendment is about the about allowing churches to have like the right. So churches have a they don't pay taxes. And part of that tax exempt status means they can't make like political they can't have a political stance.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's been around, you know,
since the 50s, since early 50s, yeah. When he was Senate Majority Leader.
And so, yeah, he wants to overturn that so the churches can go around saying, you know, whatever. And it's interesting because there's like already so many workarounds, you mm-hmm. know, to the Johnson Amendment. It's not I don't think it's unclear to like parishioners who a particular clergyman or whatever wants to support in the election. They'd make it known in other ways. You know, one of the interesting things about the Mexican vote, 29% of the Mexican vote went to Donald Trump. And part of the reason for that is that, like, you know, in these Catholic churches in Mexicans are like pretty heavy, like they're more religious than mm-hmm. than the average American. And so they would and so the pastors would say, are they pastors, fathers, whatever, I don't know, my church stuff. Anyway, they would say, don't, you know, when whatever you do when you go into the ballot box this week, just make sure you're voting for life.
Right.
And that was the big right. statement, you know, that a lot of them were making. So they didn't say Trump. They didn't say who, you know what I mean? But they made it clear that this is our position.
So I'm wrestling with this because I remember when my kids were being bar mitzvahed, this rabbi, Steve Leader from the Wilshire Boulevard Temple, bad guy, and I do mean a bad guy, Steve Leader, Rabbi Steve Leader. Wilshire Boulevard Temple, bad guy. That's, by the way, that's one of the great things about being Jewish is you can just say Rabbi Steve Leader, bad guy, and you don't. It's not a crime. You can literally.
he could sue you for defamation or something.
Well, then I'll talk about how he evicted low income people.
Right.
I'll be more than happy for him to sue me. And I have the notes on his evictions. So Rabbi Steve Leader, bad guy. And that, by the way, that's one of the lures of being Jewish is that you can tell a rabbi to go F himself. They're not conduits of God. Rabbi Steve Leader, bad guy. So, you know, his sermons were like something out of Dr. Phil and Oprah.
Okay.
And we were going to war.
Yeah.
This was in 2002, and we were about to engage in a legal invasion of Iraq and the Patriot Act. And I cornered him, and I said, hey, Rabbi Steve Leader, bad guy, why don't you talk about something? He says, but I am. I'm talking about forgiveness and love and moving on. This is BS. You know, my parents went to, but the only reason my parents went to temple was to hear guys speaking out in favor of the civil rights movement.
Mm-hmm.
This is pablum. But I can't do that because my temple, you know, there's some Republicans here. It's a mixed bag of worshipers. And I said, but I don't want to worship with them. I don't want to worship with people who support the invasion of Iraq. Well, we're inclusive. I said, well, I don't want them here. So when I think of the Johnson Amendment, I'd like to know what my
interesting
priest and rabbi believe politically, because mm-hmm. the only answer to this country is the temple of democracy.
Mm.
That Washington is a temple where we should worship. And I don't want to belong to a temple that has Trump supporters in there.
Right.
So I want full disclosure. I want to know how my rabbi
votes. I wonder how many people would end up like leaving churches and temples because they found out that their rabbi or whatever is, you know, pro-Trump or whatever it is. You know, I wonder like what effect that would have on just like basic attendance.
What is more important than who your rabbi voted for? What is more important?
I guess like if your rabbi killed a guy, that's maybe more important.
Right. Because that's where the rubber meets the road, or should meet the road in our culture. And then we wouldn't pay attention to the Yappa Napa, you know, the Milo Yappa Napalapolis. Because that's all just sound and fury signifying nothing. Who'd you vote for? And pay attention to your...
And one of the things that I think, well, that you do make a good point, which is that... At the foundation of everything, if you can't just be a pro-Trump supporter and be like, but I'm a good person. Mm-hmm. And that's one thing that I feel like we've lost track of, because by being pro-Trump, you're also pro-bigotry, you're right. pro like misogyny, you know, there that's what you're saying. However tacitly, that is what you're saying. And so I think it is really important to make that, you know, you have to be anti-Trump.
Like yes,
if you're pro like human rights and equality and shit like that, you know, that we like as Americans.
Right.
You like kind of have to be anti-Trump. So I think, yeah, you're right. Like there is that's one really easy test of knowing if someone is like in favor of, you know, equality. That's an easy test.
Like, so what are the dangers then of repealing the Johnson Amendment?
Yeah.
Because there's an establishment clause in the First Amendment. We shall have no official religion. Mm-hmm. Well, if most people in this country are what, Protestant?
Yeah.
So if Protestant churches donate the most money to our candidates, then we're running the danger of a Congress with a Protestant agenda. Is that what Lyndon Johnson was thinking?
I mean, I suppose so. And I think also just in, I don't know, there's like something about the tax exemption also muddies that up, because we're essentially just giving money to these people to run these, we're helping them out financially. It's a subsidy, you know, essentially. So, that's a good question. I mean, in one hand, you would know what you're dealing with, the garbage that you're dealing with, and on the other hand,
So let me save my listeners some time. Mm-hmm. I know that I've talked too much. I know that, and I can't control myself. I'm like the dog who bites and just has to be euthanized. I have to be euthanized. I'm filled with piss and vinegar, and I'm trying to impress you, and I'm angry about what's going on in the world, and you can send me the angry emails saying, instead of apologizing for talking too much, why don't you just shut up? I get it. Message received. Negin Farsad, where were you born?
I was born in New Haven, Connecticut. But I grew up in Southern California. I grew up in Palm Springs.
You, by appearance, in America, this is my interpretation of you have chosen to be Muslim, in that, like a Jew, you could change your name and be Megan
Tarpod.
Stewart.
Yeah.
Or Megan Stewart. I mean, right? So you've decided.
I suppose. I mean, I have one of those like just vaguely ethnic face, ambiguously ethnic faces. So
I don't think so.
It's people when they're guessing what I am, they guess a bunch of different non-white people.
So countries. You are Muslim by choice.
I mean, I'm Muslim by like I grew up. I actually think it's very similar to how a lot of my Jewish friends in New York are Jewish, which is that like they grew up in it. It's not something they really ever, like, questioned. It's not something that they're even necessarily very spiritually connected to. It's just one of those things where they're like, well, my lineage is that.
But you live in America. Okay, so do you mind if I ask you, are you in your 20s, 30s?
30s.
You're in your 30s. So you came of age right after 9/11.
Mm-hmm.
When there was a fear of Muslims,
mm-hmm.
wasn't there a voice in your head that said, change your name? You've got to make a living in America.
Mm.
Why not change your name? Why choose the path of most
resistance?
That's
so difficult. It's funny because on a casting level, like when I go out for auditions as an actor, I always wonder if my name was just Italian, you know, mm-hmm. and I kind of look Italian or Greek or, you know, some people think Mexican, but also Egyptian, Lebanese, whatever. But like, if I just change my name to an Italian name, like, would it just be like, oh yeah, we could cast her as anything, you know? But because my name is so clearly like Middle Eastern, I feel like, yeah, that part of my life has been made more difficult because for whatever reason, in terms of like American media, they cannot get their head around this person can talk, you know, this person can do any type of role. She doesn't have to be the one like brown person in the show, you know?
Right.
And so I feel like
But you're not even, I don't see you. I'm being very superficial uh-huh, here because uh-huh. I find it curious. I don't see you. You're not. You're light skinned.
Yeah, so that's curious to me too, because that the way you're looking at me is definitely not how casting directors or even bookers. I'll tell you something. Like, so I have a podcast, Fake the Nation, which you've been on. We talk about politics. I have these degrees, right? I worked for the city as a policy advisor. I, you know, like I said, I interned for Charlie Rangel. All this shit, whatever. And so you'd think I'd be a girl, like, and I go on these channels like MSNBC, CNN, whatever, and I talk about whatever, but they only trot me out when it's a Muslim thing.
Which is what I said to you. What was the thing I said to you when we started?
I don't remember.
Wait, but I don't want to bring you on.
Would you do? Right, right.
I don't want you to be the resident Muslim.
Yeah, exactly. And everybody wants me to be the resident Muslim, even though I'm like, look, I'm actually, as you said, credentialed to talk about campaign finance reform. I worked for the campaign finance board in New York City. I can mm-hmm. really talk about that. And it's so important. And it comes up all the time. Why don't you trot me out?
Right.
I mean, on one of those things. And I actually, you know, and I was asked to go on a show right after the Charlie Hebdo attacks. And I remember I went
Charlie Hebdo. The satirist.
The satirist, yeah. And there, you know, the killings,
yeah.
Yeah, in Paris.
Which they deserved.
And
in a way, they kind of deserved.
Well, I mean, I don't think anyone deserves murder, but it was. There's a way to like talk about those cartoons critically, which is like something that you're sort of like not allowed to do anymore because anyway. Yeah. Well, point is,
excuse me for one second. I apologize. They didn't deserve to be attacked. I apologize for saying that. But they were punching down. And the Muslims in France are a beleaguered group.
True.
And political satire should not be punching down and challenging a beleaguered group. Nobody deserves to be shot. I apologize. Go ahead.
Thank you for clarifying.
Yeah.
But like, you know, they bring me on the show and this is one of those calls where you're like, I shouldn't take this call. I should not go on the show. This is a nightmare. It's like everyone's too upset. It's the same. It's the day of. Nothing good will come out of a Muslim going on national television and talking about this. And so I went on and they asked me what Negin, can you explain why these Muslims did this? And mm-hmm. I was like, I mean, I don't know. I grew up in Southern California. Like, I can explain to you way more about like flip-flops than I can about why these particular Muslims would do this
right,
thing, you know?
Right.
And this is the kind of moment where you're like, are you fucking kidding me? And like, can you, like, and it's fine. And I feel like there should be reasonable Muslims going on television and talking about Muslim shit, totally. Like, and I'm happy to do that, but I cannot field a question like, why do Muslim terrorists kill people?
Right.
You know, that is out of bounds, ridiculous, and offensive. And also, again, it really, if you want to think of yourselves as independent media that, like, you know, is not, you know, is not colored by, like, the perception of someone being Muslim or black or Mexican or whatever, then don't, you know, use us for the three-dimensional beings that we are,
right,
you know
right.
what I mean? And that's something that I feel like I deal with all the time. And it's interesting because you're like, but Shonda Rhimes has so many, like, diverse shows. And it's like, yeah, I mean, it's getting better, but it's still strangely, like, stuck, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And it's still strangely, like I had to audition very recently for, like, an Indian doctor. Like I said, I'm Iranian, which... you know, in the world of Hollywood is like same thing, you
right.
know, and it's funny to me because I'm like, why can't you just say like, you're going to play an Iranian doctor, you know, like, why do you, I don't understand it. I don't understand this. And then I think, oh, maybe I'm the one that's being too fixated on this and, like, you know, maybe we're already at a, you know, Gael Garcia Bernal played an Iranian reporter, you know, in the movie Rosewater. And I'm not saying Gael Garcia Bernal isn't Iranian, but I'm saying he's definitely Mexican, you know? And so
right.
maybe we got to the point where, like...
Who was the director of that?
Jon Stewart was the director of that.
I wonder if it was a union gig. Go ahead.
No, and I love Jon Stewart, and I love Jon Stewart. But I just thought that decision was so curious, and like I also thought, you know, that. But maybe we're going in that direction, and maybe Jon Stewart is like starting a thing. Maybe then, you know, maybe Margaret Cho is going to play Paula Deen in her biopic. Like, maybe that's the direction we're going into. You know what I mean? And like, and I'm the one that's being, you know, backwards, insisting.
The
that
idea
just,
being that you, if you have somebody who's Iranian, they should hire an Iranian actor.
You know, I mean, it would be nice, since we've never gotten accuracy, to have it at least for like a couple of years before then we start blind casting.
If
you know
you
what
were,
I mean? I don't know. I
if
don't
you,
know.
Let me. Do you think you could watch? Let's just bring back the Brady Bunch,
okay,
or the Cosby Show.
Yeah.
And he has a white kid,
mm-hmm,
and it's not addressed.
Mm-hmm.
I like to think that I could watch the Brady Bunch, and they have an Asian kid and a black kid.
Yeah.
And it's not addressed.
Mm-hmm.
I know that sounds like BS.
Yeah. Well, you know, there's a show.
If they're good enough actors.
Right. I mean, like, because they're doing that on Hamilton, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, they're doing that on Hamilton. And
but they're doing it ham-fistedly.
They're doing it. There's a very specific point involved
yeah.
there. So can you do it where it's not at all an issue? You know, it's interesting because like the show This Is Us is almost kind of doing that, where, you know, it's a story of these triplets and one of them is black. Obviously, he was adopted. But I'm sorry, spoiler for people who didn't watch episode one. But I think they explain it away that way. And it's kind of like, OK, that's fine. Like, I don't even, you know, you made that explanation. This is a tight family. We're going to see family dynamics play out, and there's a black guy.
How about this? Let me ask you this. We're going to bring Angela in. Let's just keep the show going. Because until Negin wants to leave, I want to keep. So bring Angela in, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
How about this?
Angela.
Is it legal to do this? You say to. Because. I've worked in Hollywood. They are immune to any laws that are out there. They bring, hey, Angela Cobb, why don't you sit at the head of the table?
Oh, okay. No, right up there.
Oh, where? Is it, she can't sit at the head of the table? I'd like Angela to sit at the head of the table.
She gets easy access.
Easy access. Hi, Angela Cobb.
Hi, Angela.
You know Negin.
Negin.
Negin Farsad.
We're getting like 14 different pronunciations
yeah, I apologize.
From David over here.
Yes,
today.
Mister, are you, did you know each other?
No.
No.
Oh, my God. Angela Cobb is a hysterical comic.
Thank you.
I mean, really funny.
I've probably seen you.
Maybe, you actually look familiar.
And you should have her on your shows.
Yeah, for sure.
All of them.
Excuse me for one second. Are you a stage time junkie? Are you looking for?
I'm in a stage where I'm trying to. I was on a thing because I had a book come out, whatever. So I was a little less. But now I'm trying to get back and do a new hour and all that crap that people do.
So do you go? Yeah. Because Angela does.
I got a couple of shows. Yeah,
amazing.
I have one that's just like a straight stand-up show, and then the other one is themed. It's called My First Time, and people talk about losing their virginity.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. But so either one, both or whatever.
Shit, yeah. I'd love to.
All right, cool. Look at that.
Thanks for
making things happen.
Hey, a Gladwellian connector over here.
Oh, wow.
Shit.
I wish I had his hair.
He does have impressive hair.
He does.
So Negin Farsad.
Negin.
I'm such an ass.
It's fine.
Negin.
Yeah.
All right. We're talking about typecasting in Hollywood.
Okay.
During Elizabethan times. The parts of women were played by young boys.
Yeah, I know.
People were okay with it.
Yeah.
And I always maintain I don't think it should be legal for a child to be an actor or an actress. And I think the parts of children should be played by women. Because I think.
Like short women?
Whatever. I think it should be illegal to put your kid into the movies.
To profit off of them? I think about the children in Modern Family. Those.
You need kids.
They're rich.
You don't.
Yeah, you do.
No, you don't.
Yeah, you do, because kids are in life, and if actors are playing people in life, you need a kid. That's like saying you can't have a dog in Lassie. You know, you need things to be real.
A couple of kid actors that worked out okay: Fred Savage, Neil Patrick Harris.
Oh, nice.
They seem to have come. They seem to have ended great lives.
You're wrong. No.
Were you a child actor? Is that the
yes,
problem?
I was.
Oh, were
yes,
you?
I was.
Really? No.
Did you ever watch Family Ties?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was Michael Gross, the father. That's how old I am. I was a child playing the dad. I was 6 years old. That's how old I am.
I do, but I do remember learning, and even though I was an English major, but a terrible English major, but I do remember learning about with Shakespeare that they would have the men play the women's parts, which we're like, all right.
Yeah.
So in order, let me propose this to Negin.
Negin.
Boy, why would anybody like me?
What's your last name again? Negin.
What's your last name?
Farsad.
Why don't you just be like, hi, Farsad. How
can
are you?
Can you stop nagging me about your...
Continue. I almost never correct people. I don't know what I'm doing
to,
right now.
Well, now it's become a funny thing.
I'm going to call you Ms. Farsad.
Got you.
Ooh, okay.
I like that.
That sounds really formal.
Okay.
And elegant.
We were talking about being able to watch, say, the Brady Bunch, where there's six kids. Some of them are black. Some of them are whatever. And being okay with it. Not even questioning, are they adopted? Are they black actors? So Hollywood is immune to every law that is passed in Washington. Mm. The Civil Rights Act. I have been told we're only hiring white. They would never say white writers. It's a black show. We're only hiring blacks. Or you're too old.
Yeah. And do people actually say that?
Oh, yeah.
You're just too old. Straight up say
I've
that?
I've heard a lot of... yeah, not me. I'm saying guys have told me that. It's illegal.
I don't believe that. It's totally illegal. You can't say that.
But then what's weird is in the arts, how is it almost, when you think about it, though, if you're casting someone who's supposed to be a certain age, I can't play
Betty White.
Yeah, you know what I'm
Why
saying?
Why not?
Why
not?
See,
what about makeup?
But it depends on what. That's true. Actually, that's a good point, because March of the Wooden Soldiers, the Laurel and Hardy movie, the guy who plays Mr. Barnaby was actually 22. So that's a good point, actually. Yeah, those are the references I'm making.
Look, all I'm trying to say is.
So that's actually a good point.
The point I'm trying to make is I think blackface is hysterical. And I want to bring it back. By any means necessary.
Depends how, you know what's funny? Actually, I was
It's a popular opinion, and I'm glad.
No, but you know what's funny? Yeah. This is why I'm not a fan of, like, completely banning anything, because I think context is everything, and I'm going to sound like a real terrible person. But, like, let's say, for instance, take the movie with Gene Wilder and Richard Pryor. Gene Wilder can pull it off because it's funny, and it's funny because it's so badly done. Like, that's partly why
that's
it's funny.
That's part of the joke, though.
And it's not really even straight up blackface. It's more like, because blackface, when I think blackface, I think straight up minstrelsy, like the blackface, the white around the eye. Like, I think the full shebang when I think blackface. Yeah. You know what I mean? I don't just think somebody messily putting, like, a tan on their face.
Right.
You know what
I mean? But I mean, I can't.
I mean, you have, so you have blackface spectrum that you want to.
Well, I think you do, but also I think it's about the context. For instance, in All in the Family.
Traumatizing.
No, but what about in All in the Family? Like, in the episode when Archie does it, first of all, Carol O'Connor didn't even want to do it, but they do it, and it, you know, it's, the whole show was about commentary on that stuff.
Right. Well, that I think is different because it's like, exactly.
That's what I'm saying.
Because it's pulling apart the idea of doing it.
So I think it's all in how, like, I don't think it should be
context,
done.
Context, yeah.
I don't think it should
matters.
Be done, like, for fun. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's so, don't misunderstand me on that. I don't think, like, you know, hey, let's have a minstrel show in this thing for no reason. Angela, go, yeah, sure. Like, you know, and I'm Italian, so I'm already not white. I'm just kidding. But you know what I mean? So I feel if it's, like, it's like Blazing Saddles, you know? Like, there's certain things in that movie that are good for that movie.
You have, like, the film taste of a, like, 70-year-old man.
I do. Yes, I do. That's right. I totally do. I actually
Half
am a 70-year-old man.
Are like, I don't even understand. Okay, but
I actually am a 70-year-old man. No. But no, but I agree. Like, I think that, of course, like, because I remember actually, I'm one of those people who, if I can't sleep, I'll, like, randomly start researching shit. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And, like, I remember, like, I was reading about black, and it is terrible, obviously. It's insane to me, like, that was ever even a thing, you know? But then I think that if you're going to do something that, like, lampoons it or makes fun of it, that's a different thing than something that is saying it's okay, you know?
Yeah.
That's how I feel.
I have a question.
Yeah.
And how are you doing on time, Ms. Farsad?
I have about another 10 minutes.
Okay. Ooh. So then let me, since we only have 10 more minutes with Ms. Farsad, let me waste time by telling everybody that minstrel shows were the longest running form of entertainment in history.
Crazy.
And that blackface, very offensive, can still be found in Mickey Mouse. That Mickey Mouse
has
his roots in blackface and does the moves of a blackface character from a minstrel show.
You can tell even by, like, his, I mean, obviously the face, but even, like, the gloves, like, he looks like.
That's
like,
true.
Yeah, it's weird.
So you may not know this about Ms. Farsad, but she has two masters.
Oh, my God.
Ooh.
In public policy and African-American studies.
Yes.
Oh, cool.
So she's really slumming it here.
She is. No, and I appreciate.
No, but I mean, those are both degrees that you need to have to become a comedian.
And she also,
not a bad point. Yeah.
She
right.
also worked for Charlie Rangel.
Okay.
And I believe
Hillary Clinton.
You were an intern, not for Bill, because that would have been bad.
Hillary.
For Hillary.
Sorry. That's awesome.
I want to ask you a very serious question.
Okay.
And I do mean this.
Okay.
Hollywood does not follow laws. They don't follow OSHA laws. They don't follow labor laws. They do not follow any laws. If it was declared, if there were a Brown v. Board of Education for Hollywood, and the Supreme Court ruled you have to integrate your casts, that you have to integrate Broadway, that you cannot have an all-white version of Death of a Salesman. Mm-hmm. It cannot be a white family. Mm. And you literally are forced to integrate the casts of shows. There has to be affirmative action. How many generations would it take? How many years would it take until it was normalized so that you could turn on a television show and see a multiracial family and not go, well, how is this possible?
Well, the Brown v. Board of Education of Topeka is a really good example because we actually didn't then integrate schools. I mean, our record on integration is really terrible. Mm-hmm. So, it's like one of those almost unenforceable things.
Well, Kennedy
things.
Sent Nicholas Cotson back down there.
No. Totally. I mean, we did symbolically integrate schools.
Right.
Like, it's not like they're whites only or whatever. We did do that. But but actually,
sure.
you know, operationally, they're not integrated, you right. know. Mm-hmm. So that's right. like one of the problems with our school system is that they're not integrated.
Is that do you think it would help if we court ordered integration of Modern Family? I'm being serious. Court ordered integration of Family Guy.
I mean,
court integration of The Simpsons.
You know, people were really pissed when Girls came out, and they were like, "It's all white girls. Like, right. I don't care."
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
And I think that which is that, like, I don't care that Girls is an all white show. I think it's fine. It's the experience of those girls. In fact, I have a lot of white friends who only have white friends. I mean, it's not unusual, you know.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
so, and that particular.
I like the color.
And
I'm a winter. What can I tell you? You're an autumn.
You choose vanilla.
I like Twist. I've always liked Twist ice cream. Just so you know, soft serve Twist, my favorite.
My fiance is black, so you know.
You
anyways,
go.
we're like a pistachio.
So you're getting a PhD in African American studies.
Yeah, indeed. Every night, hey. But I think so. I think it's fine that that show has like a white cast or whatever, and that they are showcasing an actual thing that happens in Brooklyn with a particular type of hipster, and
true.
All of that feels really. And I enjoy the show, and I love Lena Dunham, and I think all of those people are great. However, what I don't think is great is then for HBO not to then shower that opportunity with a like situation for other ethnic groups.
Yeah,
and they're starting to tiptoe into the area, right, with shows like Insecure or whatever, mm-hmm. where they're like, oh, I guess we should also have other people that aren't white with shows like this, you know, that can become cultural touchstones. And I think that we're seeing that more and more. So that, to me, is the problem. Not that Modern Family needs to be integrated.
Right.
Modern Family, by the way, for all the shows that you could have mentioned, is actually doing a phenomenal job
right.
because they have Latinos. And they have, you know, they have gay parents,
right.
you know,
yes.
and there's like an Asian child
yeah.
who is, yeah.
yeah.
So it's like, of all the
I'm
shows
jealous.
That they're doing great.
I'm jealous of their success.
right.
That just comes, that's personal animosity.
But I think the real court order here is for networks to give opportunities to people that they don't normally give opportunities to.
But Hollywood is the only industry where you have to negotiate with them extrajudiciously, not through legislation. If there were any other industry doing this, mm-hmm. there would be laws passed.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know what it is, too, because it's the most visually, like, think about it, like a regular office. We don't see every day the goings on in, like, a regular office, but we see movies, we see shows, we see, you know, we see this
yeah,
cast
yeah.
all the time.
So it normalizes racism and sexism.
And it has the power to, but like, you know, with a show like Will and Grace or whatever, it like has a power of like bringing gay people into your living room and then you
right.
being like, you know what, I'm totally fine with them. And if they want to marry, like, that's cool. And if like,
yeah.
you know, and that was, that's was a huge part. I mean,
sure.
that show and Ellen and whatever right. were like a huge part in
well,
like getting marriage
yeah.
equality.
Yeah.
So
it's funny. That's why
there's a lot of power in it, which is why it's an important question.
Definitely. No, definitely. And that's why I made all the 70-year-old man references because no. To me, I find it hysterical that like there were shows in the 70s that now people wouldn't think of doing. You know
right,
what I mean?
Right.
To me, that's like, yeah, we did have all black cast, or we did have a show that centered around a black family. We did have a show that centered around a woman who's a you know, we had these things for a little while, and then we couldn't have them anymore for some reason, or people were like,
yeah,
oh.
Yeah, it was almost like, you know, Mary Tyler Moore and then
yeah.
nothing or
yeah.
something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, you
know,
and she's a good example. Yeah, and so it's just interesting to me that like, you know, you have like in the 70s all these like Norman Lear and all these
yeah,
really
yeah,
great
yeah.
sitcoms. And then, you know, now we're talking about it as if we've never done it before or we can't
right.
do it.
right,
like, we've
right,
done
right,
it,
right.
so let's do it again. You
right,
know?
Right. Although it was you know, a situation. And even recently, like, I remember hearing about friends working on a particular Mexican-Americans comedy show and all of their writers were white. And I was like,
yeah.
what?
Yeah,
you know, so like that kind of thing, which is, you know, and I don't know who the writing staff was for
TV,
the Jeffersons,
TV.
But
that's
I
a
won,
good point.
You know,
yeah.
I wonder
Norman
if they
Lear.
Were
Norman Lear, but also I'm sure there had to be obviously a staff. Yeah, I don't know.
Right.
This is a fact. TV perpetuates ignorance. TV is the problem. If you have a radio show, a podcast, a newspaper, a book, it doesn't matter who is talking or who is writing. TV perpetuates racism and superficiality because it's what you see. You see comes first.
Well, visual mediums in general. I mean, people talk about that all the time, even with music, that they talk about once, you know, music videos became such a big thing. They're like, you know, like we all hear my parents talk about it all the time. Like, remember back in the day when an artist could look like this and we still liked them? And now look, like you can't even, you know, like you can't even look normal. You know, it's like.
No, you can't. And it's funny, too, when you watch like British television shows and people look normal. You're like, that's so weird, you know, and you're also like, oh, I'm not stifling vomit. Like, it's fine to look at someone who looks normal.
That's a good point.
Television, except for the Rachel Maddow show, I'm serious. Television perpetuates ignorance.
Yeah.
It really does. There is nothing of value.
I think it has the power to do both.
Sort of like saying like the media is to blame for Donald Trump or whatever. I mean, there's writers, there's outlets, that are doing like great nuanced, you know, work. And I think that's, and reporting in that, I think that's the same
but
for entertainment. Like we're seeing some stuff out there that I think is, you know, that's brilliant. Like American Crime. American Crime is a really captivating show. It's really interesting and it's addressing racial issues through narrative entertainment.
Is that FX?
No, it's on, I don't know, ABC or something, but it's great. It's an anthology series.
Okay.
And it's the kind of show that's like through entertainment showing us, starting a conversation about race. The showrunner is a black man, the director of, the writer behind the 7 Years a Slave, I think, I can't remember his name. Anyway, so like there's things out there that you're like, that's brilliant. And that's hopefully moving the needle. I mean, whether or not something's moving the needle, we'll never know. That's not the way culture works. You know, you can't hook a needle up to American public consciousness, you know, and be like, did this make you less racist?
Yeah.
Like, unfortunately, we can't do that, but we need to, you know, the more we fill into the tube, like, the more hopefully we do move.
Let me dumb-splain something to you.
Dumb-splain? I like
this. Let me dumb-splain.
That's how I always explain
something to you brilliant women, okay? If you're dyslexic or blind, and you can't learn Braille or whatever, I understand the importance of radio and a podcast. I don't understand the importance of television if you're dyslexic, and you can't read. But in terms of cost effectiveness,
I'm trying to process what you're saying. I'm thinking.
In terms of the best use of your time to get information, reading. If you spend an hour to read the New York Times or the Washington Post versus spending an hour even watching Rachel Maddow, you are a better person.
The people who are most informed are people who listen to NPR. And in terms of actual being informed.
Well, but that's because they also
read. That was
read.
Like according to some study.
What
I don't know.
You're reading, too.
Well, reading The Nation, reading,
you know, I think
The Economist, reading the local newspaper. But to sit
like fun stuff, like The Nation.
But going back to the beginning, to turn on Real Time with Bill Maher and think, because I have loved ones who turn to Bill Maher for the news. They need to, they watch his monologue. And then they hear the discussion. They think they're watching a better version
of the news,
of Face the Nation. And you're not. It's screaming and yelling, and he's turning up the heat to make millions. Read. Spend that time to read, unless you're dyslexic.
Which they can still read.
Like, it's still, you can do both. I mean, that's the thing. Like, you don't need to choose.
In general, we
thing.
Should read like, more, though. Like, I joked up being a terrible English major. Like, I don't read it as much as I should.
You know,
so he's right.
I almost feel like I read too many periodicals.
Oh, I see.
Like, in just news. And I don't read enough, like, gorgeous literature.
Oh, I
that
see.
That would, like, that'll, you know, ask the eternal questions and that make me think about them. I don't do that enough.
Yeah. See, to me, it's like, I think TV has the power to do both. Like, that's the issue. Just like music has the power to do both. I think it has the power to not make people more ignorant, but it has the power to just be bullshit, which sometimes you just need some bullshit too, though.
Can I admit? Yeah.
You know, and then I think it also has the power to help shape and inform, you know, I mean, look like a show even like The Twilight Zone. Again, I'm being like 70-year-old
right, but that's
man.
Like asking the eternal questions, Twilight
but
Zone.
But also it, yeah, but see, he took that show and made it sci-fi, but addressed issues of race, gender, etc. So I think, like, you can do both. I think you can entertain, but also try to inform people.
Well, I have to leave.
Are you
sorry.
Can you storm out?
Can I
can you storm out?
Can I just, like, make a statement in closing?
Yes, you get the last word.
I just, for whatever reason, all of this talk made me remember that there's a really fun, if you just want to laugh at a show, you should watch The Grinder. It's on Netflix now.
Are you on it?
No, it's just a funny show. I have nothing to do with it. It's called Grinder or The Grinder. I don't remember.
Okay, yeah.
And it's with Rob Lowe and Fred Savage. It's totally fucking hilarious.
Oh, okay.
And it was underappreciated when it was on TV. Now it's on Netflix, and I'm telling everybody to watch it so that, like, they'll do another season
one day.
Well,
let me do this for a
And then I should all, I think America should also read my last book, How to Make White People Laugh.
How to Make White People Laugh. You'll come back?
I will. No, this
awesome.
Was super fun.
I talked too much today.
No, dude, you were great.
I was trying to impress you. And by the way, so it's Grindr, so go to www.grindr.com. Do it in front of your parents. Just go to grindr.
Just go to that site.
Grindr.com and do it, you know, in front of people. Ms. Farsad.
Thank you for having me.
Fake the Nation.
Fake the Nation, the podcast. And the last episode was with David.
Yes.
And future episodes will be with David and hopefully Angela.
Oh, yeah, I'd love to.
And so, and then How to Make White People Laugh. And the Muslims are coming.
Please come back.
Yeah, of course.
Please come back.
I had so much fun.
Okay.
Thank you.
You'll move over here, Angela, so I can face you.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. And while Angela Cobb is switching seats, yes, I know I talk too much. I did. I know.
No, I do. I literally was in here for 5 minutes and I felt like I talked
too much. No. But it's okay. I want.
It's okay when Angela talks too much. Don't say that.
The problem. Thank you for coming by.
Oh, of course.
Thank you.
My pleasure.
Angela Cobb is here. You were fantastic a couple of weeks ago on this show. What happens to me is we start taping and I've been reading. I study up before the shows.
Yeah.
And there's a temptation to use a human being as a sounding board.
And I get that. Yeah.
It's unfair. It's not a conversation. So what I've been doing to fight that tendency is to do an opening monologue where I just talk. And that kind of shuts me up. Unless I...
Not today.
Not today. How bad was it? How bad? I was angry. Was I bad? It's nice to. I haven't seen Alex.
Yeah, he's been away, right? Yeah.
This is a great show. And coming up later, we're going to talk to Lori Kilmartin Micah Fox.
Yes. So awesome.
Angela Cobb joins us. Where'd you grow up?
I'm from Long Island originally, Lynbrook. And then we moved upstate when I was nine. So I technically spent most of my growing up upstate, but I feel like I come off as much more of, you know, like a
New Yorker.
Right, yeah.
It's bizarre because I grew up in New Jersey, New York.
Right.
There was a time when you could judge a person by whether or not they watched Channel 5 or Channel 11.
Oh, see, I was on Long Island long enough to remember that kind of stuff because I left when I was nine. So
And 11 had a certain, like 11 carried the Munsters.
Yeah.
And the Honeymooners.
Yeah.
And 5 was a little, just a tad more cooler.
Right. Yes.
But you're not my age.
No, but I'm remembering even like, I'm trying to remember now when I was a kid and I'd watch both those channels. I feel like 11 still would have the Honeymooners and stuff like that.
Right. And there's this little cultural divide that I made that it's Munsters versus the Addams Family. It's Lost in Space versus Star Trek.
Uh-huh.
It's even now it's Family Guy versus The Simpsons. So I maintain, this is my, I think we're on the same page. I liked Lost in Space more than I like Star Trek. I like the Munsters more than I like the Addams Family.
The Munsters I can get on board with. The other ones I don't really know enough about because I haven't watched
them. I like Family Guy more than I like The Simpsons. So I'm considered lowbrow and not hip. And I think that's a Channel 11 WPIX. This is, you have to be from New York
right,
to get this. And I think you're a WPIX Channel 11 type of person. You know, I think we're on the same page.
You know what's funny? Like, I think that I... Like, this whole lowbrow, highbrow, or whatever, like, mm-hmm. It's funny when you said, like, the Munsters, because I consider if people don't like the Munsters, I wouldn't consider them intelligent. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'd be like, you don't like the Munsters? Well, or you don't even, you know, I don't know. To me, there's certain classics you should at least know about.
But what do you, but people, if you told people you liked the Munsters, Addams Family fans would dismiss you.
It's funny because that's like the Three Stooges and the Marx Brothers, too. Like, I'm the Three Stooges, but a lot of
me
people
too.
Yeah, would be like, oh, the Marx Brothers is smarter. I don't like the whole dumber, smarter. Like, that, you know, that's like saying, I mean, I don't know. To me, the Stooges had their intelligence, too. It's just different, mm-hmm. you know? There's plenty of stuff I like that's smarter, considered smarter in air quotes, or stuff I like that's considered, you know, more lowbrow. And I just like what I like. I don't really, you know.
The Three Stooges didn't sit around the Algonquin table.
That's true.
Not to dismiss the Marx Brothers, but I don't care.
No, this is great. I'm excited about this.
I like the Three Stooges.
Exactly.
When a Marx Brothers film comes on, it's an assignment from my dad. Oh, you know, S.J. Perlman and George Kaufman. You have to get these right. You sit down and watch it. When the Stooges come on, I'm going, all right, I'm in. I'm all in.
Yeah. You know what's funny, too? There are people that I like to watch versus people I like to quote. Like, Groucho Marx has some brilliant quotes and philosophies mm-hmm. on life. Like, right. I, like, I'd rather probably read a book written by Groucho Marx than watch the Marx Brothers versus the Three Stooges I'll watch forever, you know.
Right.
And laugh hysterically. Yeah,
Groucho was a great writer.
Yeah, he's brilliant.
Books,
yeah,
and his letters are all brilliant. Mm-hmm. But the Stooges, pound for pound, laugh for laugh,
I'm the same way.
Were amazing. They were.
I agree.
Did you grow up with mostly brothers?
No, actually, it's funny how I became a tomboy as a kid. I have one sister who's 5 years younger than me, and then that was it. And me and my mom, my dad, and me and my sister. Yeah.
Okay. And when did you start doing comedy?
I started doing comedy.
Turn off your phone.
I know. Look at this. I got.
What happened?
I started doing. No.
What's on your phone?
No, nothing important actually. Just a message. It looks like a message about a show.
What's the message?
I'm not gonna read the.
What's the message? Booked?
No. It's somebody asking me about Fun Size and Venti, the show I co-host. You've done Fun Size and Venti. Yeah. Okay. That's all.
It's so much Venti to do your show.
So much Venti.
So much Venti.
No. Anyway, sorry to get off topic here.
So go ahead.
I didn't grow up with brothers. I have a younger sister. But because my mom didn't have sisters, I think that's part of what it is. My mom is the only girl. She's the youngest and the only girl, and has three older brothers. So she grew up all with brothers. And I think so because, like, my mom didn't have a sister and my dad just had a brother, I grew up around a lot of guys, mm-hmm. even though I didn't have brothers, if that makes sense. So mm-hmm. there were uncles, not aunts. You know what
right.
I mean? And it was – so that could be part of it.
You don't have a chip on your shoulder. Most comics have – rage and anger.
It's funny that you say that. Maybe I just hide it well.
I don't sense.
We all have our shit, I think. But I definitely feel like, you know, had you met me a couple of years ago, maybe you would have said something different. Like, I think past few years, I feel like I've kind of come into my own a little more than maybe when I first started comedy. I think if when I first started comedy, people would have been like, she's a little defensive or she's a little insecure or that mm-hmm. kind of thing.
How many years have you been doing?
Seven years. Yeah.
And do you measure your comedy by the number of years you've been doing? Because I have noticed time has shifted with younger comics in terms of measuring their success.
What do you like? Can you explain what you mean?
Well, Will Durst taught me the law of comedy, and then Malcolm Gladwell years later said it's true. Will said it takes 4 years for a comic to think he's good, mm-hmm. 6 years for the audience to know he's good, and 10 years for it to be undeniable.
Wow. Yeah, I like that.
That's what Will Durst said to me, you know, because I was so impatient and I calmed down. And then Gladwell wrote that book about 8 years ago,
sure.
where he says it's basically 10 years. It takes 10 years for somebody to become more than proficient but excellent at anything. Do you, with the rise of social media and fame becoming more important than substance, where you really can, as a comic, become famous before you become good?
Oh, yeah.
Right?
You definitely can, for sure. I think that's 100% true.
So what are the yardsticks in terms of time?
See, it's funny. I feel like I've always had confidence in my ability, but now I'm at a point where, you know, I feel like I'm a good comic. You know what I mean? And thank you. I do agree with the 10-year thing, though, that, like, probably to really be, like, excellent or undeniable or whatever. That makes sense, I think. Because even a band like the Beatles, who were together for under 10 years, but they had been playing for years before then. So it,
right.
Yeah. But for me, like,
I'm sorry to interrupt. Alex, isn't it like 10,000 hours? What?
Yeah.
10,000
yeah,
hours.
I've heard that.
Right. In my case, he said, 100,000 hours. You have a microphone back there? Huh?
Nice.
Oh, we can hear you?
No.
Oh, okay. Oh.
It's funny, like, I joke with people, though, sometimes that I'm like, you know, considering the fact that I really don't have that, I don't really have any legit credits to speak of, but yet people respect me enough. You know what I mean? Like, so I'm at the point where I feel like people see what I do and they see I'm a good comic, and the rest I'm kind of like, will come, I feel. Not that the rest will come like I don't have to do anything, but.
Did you figure that out, or did somebody tell you that?
I don't, it's funny. I was lucky when I first started to also, like, surround myself with people who've been doing it a while. Like I took a class at Broadway with Frank Vignola, and he's still a really good friend of mine, and he's brilliant, I think. And his sort of talking about being in the industry for a long time and that kind of stuff, I found helpful when I was new. And other people too, you know, that I just kind of happened to fall in with, who could kind of be like, look, like, this isn't going to matter in another day, or, like, you know, don't worry about it, or, you know. But then some of it, I think, because I came from, like, I always did performing and writing type stuff. Like, I was in band and chorus and that kind of stuff in school. So I knew that, like, you could have, like, a bad performance, and that doesn't mean you sucked. You know what I mean? So I guess I had a little bit of a perspective on it, too, just, like, naturally.
What have older comics or older people taught you that turned out to be wrong? I'll give you an example.
Oh, okay.
Of what I was taught.
Yeah, yeah. Let's hear it.
Will Durst gave me great advice about even with the podcast. Mm-hmm. We're coming in 3 years. We'll have done it 10 years.
Oh, that's great.
And I think that's when this thing will, you know, be what it's supposed to be. The thing that I was taught starting out was be so good it's undeniable, and everything else will flow.
Mm-hmm.
That don't focus on marketing. Don't focus on glad handing. I saw an interview with Steve Martin a couple of years ago where he said, you know, I never like going to parties. So what can I do to avoid going to parties but still get work?
Sure.
Just be so great that it's undeniable. I think that's partly bad advice.
Yeah, I mean, I think that it's funny. Like, I know a lot of comics who I think they're great, and yet they'll be like, oh, you know, I hate, like, having to, like, schmooze with people, or I hate. Whereas for me, like, I guess I come off as very outgoing. For me, once I've done comedy and I'm in a comedy environment, I feel like I'm at my best. Like, I'm more outgoing. I'm more social. I'm more this, and the other thing. Whereas if you asked me to maybe go schmooze at a party for, like, a day job I had or something like that, I probably wouldn't be as competent, because I wouldn't really have all this much investment or faith in what I was selling or what I was doing.
Right.
Whereas for me, it just kind of comes naturally that, like, if people came to my show, I'm going to, like, shake their hands after and thank them for coming and ask them how they liked it. And, you know, it just kind of...
You do that.
I do.
Okay, so the advice that I was given starting out in San Francisco before your parents were born,
no,
was don't let the audience see you before you go on stage. And afterwards, you should go to your dressing room and hide. Be mysterious.
Yeah.
That's wrong, right?
I don't know. See, but I think also different things work for different people, too.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if your, like, aura is that, like, you're mysterious, you know what I mean? I think it's almost like, not to sound weird, but it's almost like being off brand can be your brand almost. You know what
right.
I mean? It's like you don't care about that, so you're, you know. I also think if you're good, like, I think if you suck, then whatever you do is going to be wrong. Versus if you're good, you can, you know. It should all always my, be more important about my, the good, I think.
Yeah, all my heroes were mysterious. Like Woody Allen mm-hmm. was mysterious.
I like his stand-up.
You go, what's he? You know, he never went on television to promote his movies.
Right.
He became special.
Yeah.
And so, I think my generation of comics thought, well, if you hide and only show a little to the audience, then you'll be mysterious and people will want more of you. Supply and demand.
Sure.
But that doesn't apply anymore.
I think there's like a happy medium, because when I even think of the types of people that I admire in the arts, like it's kind of people who have more of my personality type, but then also some people who really don't. Like I'd hear a lot of things from like somebody like Mel Brooks. He's mm-hmm. brilliant, I think, but also he's outgoing and gregarious naturally. So you could tell he's totally comfortable being like, come see my movie. You know what I mean?
Right.
Whereas someone like a Marty Feldman or even a Gene Wilder, they were more like, oh, I hate doing this promotion stuff. You know, and it's like, I'm kind of like, really? Why though? What you did was brilliant. So go promote it. You know? And even like you look at the Beatles, like Lennon McCartney, like McCartney had more of like the diplomatic kind of PR kind of quality, whereas Lennon would tell people to go fuck, not that he couldn't be charming either, but was willing to tell people to go fuck themselves or didn't necessarily get invested in the other sort of fluff of it, you know?
Right.
But at the same time, then you see him when he's a solo artist and he's totally promoting the shit out of himself.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you have to, I think your personality is important, but then also it's about kind of, you have to have a good product in general. Like, mm-hmm. I don't care how much you promote something. If it sucks, it sucks. You know what I mean? Like,
So after a show, you'll talk to audience members.
Yeah, I try. Particularly if I produce a show.
How do you know when to end a conversation?
How do I? See, I have. I don't know.
So it's after a show, and people walk up to you, and they talk to you.
Yeah, I guess it depends how the conversation's going. You know what I mean? If it's like. Sometimes it's people on their way out, so usually those conversations will naturally either the people are on their way out and we're chit-chatting maybe and then they leave, or it'll be like, oh, let's get a drink, or like that kind of thing. Sometimes.
And will you go get a drink with them?
Yeah, I've hung out. I had a show one time. It was me, it was Robin Shawl, her show at Caroline's,
uh-huh.
and there were these guys from Canada who were really fun, and then we all went out for drinks after. Yeah, because it was like...
The Mark Norman.
Remember? Oh, well, I'll be right back.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I was at the Cellar with Alex one night.
That's funny.
And Mark Norman, who's a you know, great comic.
Yeah, he's great. I like Mark a lot.
Just really did something very smart. He was obviously working the room at the Cellar. He acknowledged me, but he didn't want to sit next to me because why? Who would want to sit next to me?
Oh, stop.
And he went, I'll be right back.
And then, yeah.
And he left. And then all night, I'll be right back. And I thought, oh, that's brilliant.
Yeah.
That's a great
way to...
Well,
see, that is... I think maybe that's where I get... I feel like I have, like, the qualities of almost, like, both sides of my family in that I have a natural thing where I do want to talk to people and I do like people. But I also don't like bullshit. So I'll find ways to avoid or sort of dodge a situation, too, if... Yeah. So... I think it's about that happy medium where you want to promote yourself and sort of, you know, be willing to talk to people and network, but mm-hmm. also not be fake. Like, I don't feel I'm fake. Like,
No.
And I know that sounds like something a fake person would say.
No, you're not.
But I feel like I'm pretty genuine and, you know, it kind of comes naturally to me if it's something I enjoy doing. Like, this is what I want to be more successful at, you know, than I am. And, like, this is what I want to do.
Well, I think the audience really responds to you because they get a sense that you would go have a drink with them.
I see.
It's literally, and in politics, that's literally why George W. Bush got elected, is you got a sense that he would go, even though he was an alcoholic, he would go have a drink with you, whereas Al Gore...
And yeah.
I'm kind of like Al Gore.
Yeah,
in that I put off a vibe, you know, this guy wouldn't have a drink with me, and I'm glad because he'd be a bore.
That's funny. See,
he's a feat... And I don't like them.
And it's funny, see, but I'm drawn, I find myself drawn to people in a way who, like, to me, you'd be the kind of person that I'd be like, oh, come have a drink. And I'd want to get you to come have a drink with me. Like, I'd
right.
see it
and
almost as like a challenge.
No,
I wouldn't be I definitely wouldn't be disappointed. I'm saying I think because I see that side of my own personality, too, but I think outwardly that doesn't come off as much with me. But I definitely get the idea of, like, I just want to, you know, screw these people. I just want to go back to my, you know, roommate. So then I almost want to get you to come have a drink so then we can talk about, like, how shitty some of the annoying people in the audience were, you know,
right.
like that kind of thing.
I think what holds me back as a human being is that I like to perform. I love to kill, but I'm doing it for me, not the audience.
Right, which I think, but see, for stand-up, you're supposed to do it for you, I think.
And then when I'm done, I'm done.
Right, well, I get that. Okay.
I objectify the audience.
I get that. Okay.
I just see this mass of people, or in my case, three drunks. I see a crowd. I go, okay, how do I mechanically make these people
I see what you're
laugh
saying.
As hard as they possibly can? And I do want to talk to them after a little, but...
Of course, it all depends how it goes. Obviously, if you... Well, first of all, if you do shitty, nobody usually wants to talk to you anyway.
Right.
So then it just all kind of all works out that way, you know, because you probably aren't really in the mood to talk to them. But, like...
I like talking to people. Like, on this show, I want to do more listener questions, and I want to talk to my listeners.
Yeah.
I like emailing with them back and forth. But there has to be a reason. There has to be an efficiency and a point to the conversation. You know, after a show, everybody's drunk or, you know.
I see what you're saying.
This is like a time suck in a way.
Ah, so you're very – maybe that's part of it too. Like I'm bad in that I really don't mind wasting time. Like I feel like I'm
– Well, you're young.
But there are plenty of young people who think like you who are very efficient and are very like, what's the point of this? Whereas I'm kind of like – What's the point is, well, I just, you know, I feel like hanging out, so I'm just going to hang out, you know, unless, obviously it's different if you have something else like you have to be at or then, you know, that makes sense, but.
Well, I'm an alcoholic, so I wasted 12 years of my life. So once I sobered up, I said, I'm never going to waste a single minute.
Gotcha. Well, that's good, too.
And now what's happened is I've completely cut myself off from the world.
I see.
And I'm living this life, this ascetic life. Is it ascetic? Ascetic life? Hasidic. Hasidic life. Where every second, every minute, I have to justify.
Oh, I see. Now, 12 years you said you've been sober?
No. I drank for 12 years.
Oh, how long have you been sober?
I'm 58, so I quit when I was 30.
Oh, okay. Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
See, I will have to... I have a joke that I do sometimes on stage. Like my mom remembers everybody's birthday. Like if she met you, and you told her your birthday, she'd remember your birthday forever.
Right.
Whereas me, I go, how many people I hang out with? I go, I remember sobriety anniversaries. And I'll like reach out to people. Happy sobriety anniversary. I get it. Okay. I get it.
I had an interesting experience. I did a roast battle. I'm not going to mention the club because I love the club, but I just don't want to mention the club. And there was just a lot of people smoking pot.
Okay.
And one side of me thought, man, I wish I could just be as happy and stoned as these people. But I said it was a very close. There were about 10 comics in this tight-knit room. And there was something very social. I kind of closed my eyes and thought, everybody in this room is stoned and relaxed. Is there a way for me to meditate to get to that level? And I had to work at it, but I did eventually get to a point where I was deep breathing and was on their I wasn't going to be as happy as they were, but I was connected to them.
That's
which was kind of nice.
Yeah.
Do you smoke pot? Or are you allowed to talk about that?
You know, it's funny. I do it socially. Like if someone has some, I'll have some, but it doesn't really do much for me. So I'm not the kind of person who's going to go buy it or, you know, and the one or two times I've done edibles, that was actually better for me than smoking it.
Really? But, most people have bad.
Yeah. But I don't really do it regularly because it doesn't really do, you know, usually just drinking is enough for me, honestly, like, you know, and I even try not to drink that much either. But, I don't really smoke pot that much.
You don't smoke. Yeah, I do notice that more and more people around me are smoking pot, probably because they need pot to be around me. But I do see
A lot of comics enjoy it. I know.
More and more.
Yeah. Whereas wasn't it like, I want to say, comics in like the 80s and 90s, wasn't cocaine the big thing for comics then?
Supposedly.
Okay, yeah. No, I'm just curious.
I'm amazed that anybody... That was the other thing that I had never understood in San Francisco. Where do you have the money to do cocaine?
It's funny, like my... Well, I don't know if it was just less expensive back in the day. I don't know. Like, I... my parents would joke, would talk about, and I never considered that. I mean, my dad's an alcoholic, but I never considered my parents particularly like crazy rebels or anything like that. They just
now, is that a violation of a trust when you say that?
No, I mean, he's not in recovery or anything, so.
Oh, he's still drinking.
Yeah, he varying degrees of sobriety, but right. No, it's not a violation of anything. I do jokes about it.
Have you decided he's an alcoholic?
Have I decided? It's come one of those things that's like, from when I was a kid, okay, when I was 14, he actually went to rehab and was sober for like 5 years. Okay. But I think he got dragged there like kicking and screaming type deal, which right. I don't think ever seems to work for anybody who's trying to get sober. It seems right. like it has to be like a decision. Either they hit their bottom or whatever. Then, you know, like started drinking again or whatever. And when I did comedy from hanging out with more comics who were in recovery and learning more about, like I've been to like adult child of alcoholics meetings or like codependence anonymous meetings and stuff like that. So from learning more about it, I'm like, yeah, he's, you know, definitely, you know, this is.
And so stand up is one of the things you can control.
Yeah, that's true.
You can try to control an audience. Most of the time it doesn't work, but occasionally there's the hope of justice.
Right.
Which is. What I found attractive about comedy was I couldn't control the way I was raised. I couldn't control the way women felt about me or the way I felt about myself. But I could create this alternative universe
yeah.
where on stage I was somebody else and I could control how you perceived me.
Yeah.
And I would take notes. This joke works. Keep it in. This joke doesn't work. Take it out.
Right.
So what? Eventually, when you build an act, you have, you know, 250 jokes that the audience likes. The audience likes you because you have a list of 250 jokes that will make them like you. And I, in relationships, I have asked for lists where I've said, give me a list of how you want me to behave.
And see, I'll
be what you want me to be. Just give me a list
tasks
and I'll be that person.
It's interesting. See, well, there's a couple of things here. I think one of the smartest things when we talked about like things comics have said to you who have been doing it longer, like Frank Vignola said, and I totally think this is true, that like the idea is not to go to the audience. It's like to make the audience come to you and like get in your head. And that's when you're really doing it right. And I think that that's true because I think there is a way to get the audience in your head. And also they're going to find you funny, too. You know, like everybody can kind of be happy.
They want authenticity. There's two.
Yeah, authenticity.
They want authenticity. So there are two things going on here. And it's two different types of performer. There's the sweat act like me. Who will do jokes, who does jokes, and it's mechanical and scientific. And then there's the authentic comic. And people my age tend to go, what are they laughing at?
Like, yeah.
You watch Richard Pryor.
No, no.
And I go, where are the jokes? Oh, he's being authentic.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
And so Richard Pryor, who... The antithesis of Richard Pryor is Carlin,
right?
Who is just old school joke guy, dangerous, and authentic because of his mind,
right? See,
Pryor is authentic because of his heart,
right? I get what you're saying, but I also think it's like
and mind,
yeah. But also, like, you could be as authentic as you want, but like, you also don't need to know how to write a joke, in my opinion.
I think there is. And I think what's saving comedy is that your generation values authenticity more than jokes. And that is what's keeping stand-up alive because it's more than a joke. It's unique.
Well, that's true, too.
You have to be a human being.
That's true, too. I do think that no matter how well-written a joke is, like if they can't believe it from you, then it's not going to work. You know what I'm
trying to say? That's not true.
You don't think so?
No. That one of the reasons I'm able to work with Martin Short or Steve Martin is because everything they say is a lie. And my act is a lie.
But I'm saying the audience believes it.
No, they don't.
They don't believe it?
No, and that's what the laugh is. The joke, the reason I get a laugh, or the reason Steve Martin gets a laugh, or the reason Martin Short gets a laugh. And by the way, the whole subtext of this is my putting myself in the company of those two.
Yeah,
is that,
why not?
Is that you know it's not true.
Oh, I see. All right, but then there's still something going on that they almost get it, I guess, because they believe it's almost like either suspension of disbelief. I feel like there's still something going on where they're on board.
Well, they love the performer,
right? Yeah,
and they're willing to. I forget everybody else. I mean, my hero was Rodney Dangerfield.
Okay.
Because he could say anything on stage.
Yeah.
As long as the joke was good.
Right, I see. Well, so that's like the combination, though, I think, of your personality and your authenticity versus, like, even if you're telling a joke that's not who you are, if you're being who you are genuinely as you're telling the joke, you could get away with it.
Well, yeah, but if you're not being who you are, you can say, like, I have a joke that never works. I don't know why I'm bringing this up, but I do a joke that I think is funny. I was date raped in prison. Now, you can't get a laugh from the word date raped.
Right.
But technically, it's a funny joke, and in front of the right audience, it should work in that they know I was never date raped in prison. They know I didn't go to prison. They know this.
Oh, right. Yeah, I see what you're saying.
And then so you can create this. I don't know why I brought that up, because it's a joke that has never worked on stage except for a very select
group. Yeah, well, we all have those.
You know, it's one of those things where I'll do it in front of 300 people and there'll be five people who laugh hysterically.
And you're like, that's it. I'm keeping this.
And you say, well, five out of 300, if consistently five out of 300 people laugh at that, that does mean it's funny.
Right.
Right?
Yeah, that's the thing. It is funny. It just maybe not necessarily... majority funny.
It's not palatable.
I see. Yeah, palatable.
But it's
that's
funny.
Yeah. Well, that's a good point, too, because there are plenty of things that are, funny. Funny doesn't necessarily mean it has to be happy, good, just it's funny.
I have, one of the reasons I don't work the road anymore is I have actually stopped my show to explain why the joke was funny. Why,
I like that.
Why my being date raped in prison is actually
funny.
And apparently that's not good for a comic
that's
to do
not
that
good.
On a
no,
Friday night.
I guess not.
Where you have to explain, you have to say to the audience, let me explain to you why 295 out of 300 people here are completely wrong. There are five people who understand this,
right.
And you're all against me. Yeah. Do you get angry at an audience?
I feel like when I'm angry, I'm not funny, actually. That's one thing that I actually have even tried. There are certain types of even jokes or things that like I've even tried to talk about that I feel like if people are aware that I'm really pissed, it's mm-hmm. not funny. I don't know why. Like, some people are really funny when they're pissed. I don't feel like I'm funny on stage when I'm pissed.
Right.
Maybe in life I'm funny when I'm pissed.
Right.
But on stage, I feel like I have to have some sense. They have to really be like, no, Angela's in control of herself and of the situation when I'm on stage. I feel mm-hmm. like for me to be funny. Whereas if... I'm kind of really just pissed. It doesn't seem to work for me. I don't know. People, or maybe people find it jarring because of the fact that I come off as very like, either like you said, like I do come off maybe as gregarious or outgoing. So then if I seem pissed, it's like, oh shit, like what's going to happen? You know.
When was the last time you performed where you thought to yourself, I should no longer be doing this?
This is going to sound really, really arrogant, but I actually haven't had that happen. Like, I've had shitty performances, but I've never thought I should never do this. I've always been like, I'll do it. Like, it's always been what I've liked and what I wanted to do. So even if it's gone bad, I'll feel down about it, or I'll feel like, okay, like, I really got to, like, work on some shit, or I got to buck up, I got to do more mics, or I got to, you know, whatever. But I've never actually had that moment where, and I know that I've heard plenty of people say, you know, every comic should have that moment or whatever. But no, I've never had that moment where I'm completely considered not doing it.
Never.
No, I haven't. I truly haven't.
So then you are going to be an incredibly successful comic. You've never ever.
I really have. Like we've all had doubts and we've all had insecurities or felt bad about ourselves because the show was bad or we felt like, oh shit, like I suck or like. But I've never actually had it enough where I've been like, I want to walk away from this and never do it again. I really have never had that happen.
Well, most comics do.
Yeah, no, it's more almost like I have the philosophy of like almost like if it goes bad, it's almost like I think to myself, all right, like I'll go show them next time or like I get almost like a. I'll go prove them wrong kind of a thing mm-hmm. to, you know. But no, I've never actually considered not doing it yet. I mean, who knows? It could happen, but I haven't considered it.
I think that is the secret to comedy. People like me walk away from it. Oh, I'll go take a writing job. Sure. Comedy. I did comedy straight for 12 years.
Okay.
I know. Nickname already is writing down. We have a listener who tweets my show and responds. So,
oh, cool.
I don't know who he is. His name is Nickname. So I've just said Nickname. I did comedy straight for 12 years. I know what your response is going to be, Nickname, but go ahead anyway. And then I hit the wall financially, and I took writing jobs, and I took stand up for granted. Oh, that's something. I'll always be funny.
I see.
And you pay a price for that. The guys who just kept doing it, either some of them kept doing it and they shouldn't have.
Right. Know. Oh, of course. Well, there's that. Absolutely.
And that's not for me to decide. That's
sure.
for their loved ones to decide. I mean, and if you need to do it, keep doing it.
Right. Oh, you mean like for their life? You don't mean lack of talent. You mean like their lifestyle and like that kind of stuff? Or
lack of luck.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Where you find yourself maybe on a cruise ship away from your family for 3 weeks.
I see. Okay.
No, you know, there are, I mean, I am not judging, but for me, and I never played a cruise ship, but to end up on a cruise ship away from my family for 2 weeks to do three shows seems like, for me, it would be hell. But I
really?
Don't. But
yeah. No, it's funny. Well, you know, Al Martin, who owner and booker of Broadway Comedy Club. One of the things he said too, when I was brand new and like I auditioned for him and stuff, he would say it's important in this business to travel light, or like particularly when you're starting out, mm-hmm. it seems like travel. And I remember at the time, like I was still a virgin. I was like, oh, I travel anorexic. Like I have no boyfriend. I have no whatever. I got nothing. So don't worry about that. And I don't give a shit about my day job. Like I'm very, but I do think that that's a good point. Like when you say that to me, like if somebody offered me a cruise ship, I'd take it right now.
Me too.
Like, yeah, but I don't have a kid. I don't have a husband. I don't have a, you know what I'm trying to say. So I do understand then how it becomes when, you know, my mom would say about this, you know, when your life isn't your own anymore almost, or you have other people you have to look out for too,
right.
aside from yourself. Yeah, then you do have considerations that you need to make. Absolutely. Or you have to work it out with your spouse or your boyfriend, girlfriend, whatever. And, you know, sure.
We have to take a break. We're talking with Angela Cobb. We'll be back after this. I'm going to say something to our guest. Before I introduce our guest, I want to just piss him off and say, let's start the clock. We've just found out that Micah Fox has a migraine, so she can't make it. And Lori Kilmartin is stuck in L.A. I guess they're having rain. Mm-hmm. And Angela Cobb is with us.
Hi.
On the line is what a treat. What a treat to have this next gentleman on the show. His State of the Industry from 1996 at the Just for Laughs Festival is available for download right now on iTunes. Go to iTunes.
Ooh.
Yes, go to iTunes right now and download Andy Kindler's 1996 Just for Laughs State of the
Laughing. Stop laughing when you're promoting something.
Oh, I'm doing the Bill Maher School of Comedy.
No, no, no. He laughs because it's so funny. You laugh because you're mocking. You're mocking an old recording. That's not even, it's available on cassette tape, by the way.
You have to download a cassette player on iTunes.
No, you can't download. You send to Burrell's Burrell's transcripts.
What about Merkel Press?
I don't even know that one. Send it to Michael C. Cena, Chicago, Illinois, 60609.
Oh, my God. Andy Kim.
Hey, do you have a Longines symphonette? Spare me. I don't even know what these words mean. That's how disturbed I am. I don't know what a long. I think it's a watch.
Andy Kindler joins us. Tell me about this, because I'm going to go. I believe it or not, if I weren't lucky enough to be speaking with you right now, I'd be on iTunes downloading your 1996 Just for Laughs State of the Industry speech on iTunes. What do you type?
My old job.
We're dating now.
We're dating.
That was the mayor. Hey, so how do I download? I'm serious. I want to buy this. So tell me how do I buy this?
And we'll be back with more. We'll be back with more Jews instructing Jews after these messages. Can't look at the top of your pull down screen. On the upper right hand corner of your computer screen, there will be a pull down menu.
Okay, that's the thing with the letters on it that I put my fingers on and push down.
Select download Jew material when it pops up.
Okay, and then I hit return. Or enter.
Hit return. That's what I was hoping every time I would do Evening at the Improv. They would hit return.
My mother is such a Zionist and so anti-Palestinian, she's taken the return key off her typewriter. I don't know what that means.
Have you heard this? What's that?
It's the right of return. It's an Oslo Accord joke.
I know that one. Do you know that there's David, do you know there's an organization?
Hang on, I just did something. Are you there?
All right.
Okay, so start again.
I'm here.
Start again, please.
Do you remember when you could give a donation to an organization, they plant a tree in Israel? You know that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Plant a tree in Israel. That same organization, you can give to them, they will remove a settler from the West Bank. In your name. In your name. In your name.
In my name.
There's a little plaque. They'll put a plaque where the Jew settler used to live.
Are you a fan of Bibi?
Oh, he's so good. You know, he's if Trump was doing it the right way. He's Trump, but with a solid head on his shoulders.
Do you believe they...
I mean, whatever... If Rabin was so good, what happened to whatever happened to that Rabin if he was so great?
I think Leah Rabin.
What?
Leah Rabin, Yitzhak Rabin's wife, as she said.
That was a bad joke, by the way. I said
no. I was going to answer that question.
Okay.
As Leah Rabin said at her husband's funeral to Bibi Netanyahu, "You killed him." That's in response.
Oh, my God.
Did you know she said that to him?
No, I did not know that.
Yeah. So that's what you were pretty much saying, is that Benjamin Netanyahu, after Yitzhak Rabin was moving very close to a two-state solution with the Palestinians, drummed up nationalist, anti-Palestinian Islamophobia in Israel that provoked a zealot to shoot Yitzhak Rabin. That was the joke you were making, correct?
Yes. Yes. But, David, can I interject one more joke?
Yes, sure.
At my dad's funeral.
Go on.
My mom turned to me and she said, "I have to, but you?"
A guy walks into...
I think that's the wrong punchline. That might be the wrong punchline for a different joke.
I remember when my father died, the rabbi asked me, how old was he? And I said, 71. And the rabbi said, beef and broccoli?
Well, my favorite joke in the world, one of my favorite jokes is the Jewish woman who calls the paper. She wants to put an announcement because her husband died. She says, my husband died. I want to put an announcement. How much is it? $5 a word. Oh, that's very expensive. Okay, just put in Saul died. Oh, I'm sorry, ma'am. There's a five-word minimum. Oh, it's very expensive. Okay, put in Saul died Volvo for sale.
Here's the truth. This is true. My father on his deathbed. This is a true story. We brought apple strudel because, you know, and he literally said, "Don't touch it. It's for after the funeral." I swear to God,
David,
on my life, I swear to God, that's true. You know that joke, right?
No, I don't know that joke. Oh, I know. I don't know it. No.
Oh,
I thought that was an ad lib.
No. There's a famous Jewish joke. You know, Saul is dying, going in and out of a coma, and he's going, Becky, and he passes. Yeah, you got to stretch it out for 3 minutes, and then he goes, "Do I smell apple strudel?" And she goes, "It's for after the funeral."
Well, this is an absolutely true story. There was a comedian from Canada. His name was Stan Schachter, and he was so funny. And he told me, he goes, "Andy, I went to play this Jewish retirement home, and they told me, Stanley, don't go over 20 minutes because we're having with your act because we're having sponge cake. And believe me, when they smell the sponge cake, the show is over."
Jews and food. I was at a bar mitzvah, a very fancy bar mitzvah, and the dinner gets served, and all the Jews are looking at what do you got? What I got this? I got this. What do you got? And I said, you know, you Jewish women, all you do is talk about food, but you're not willing to do anything about it, because the stereotype is that Jewish women are horrible cooks. Was your mother a good cook?
No.
Yeah, my mother would say, "I made dinner," and I would say, "What did I do to you that you would inflict such pain on me to put this in front of me?" But anyway, I said, "So you women do nothing, you Jewish women do nothing about food. All you do is talk about it." And there was a South African couple, and they said, "You know, Jewish women in South Africa were great cooks until the end of apartheid. This is true." And I go, how did the end of apartheid destroy Jewish cooking? And they said, well, it wasn't just blacks in South Africa. It was Asians who weren't allowed to mingle. Once Jewish people discovered Chinese food in South Africa, Jewish women checked out of the kitchen.
I'll tell you, apartheid sounded like a lot of fun, but this angle to it like you can make a big chill from this kind of information.
Well, you know, there are unintended consequences. You and I both, unlike Dick Cheney, were for the end of apartheid.
Well, you told me you used to write The Lighter Side of Apartheid by Dave Berg.
Okay, so now that we've...
Okay, let's get down to business.
Let's get down to business. You don't like Bibi Netanyahu. You think there's a...
I hate him. I hate him like poison. And you know, there's a woman I saw on CNN last night on your favorite show, Don Lemon. And... I don't know why you love that guy. I find him very annoying, but you're like, Andy, call me up. Andy, watch Don Lemon. I'll watch it. I'm taping it. Believe me. I'll see it.
Andy, I call you up every night, and I go, you would not believe. There was a very bigoted guest, and you would not believe what Don Lemon didn't say to them.
Well, Don Lemon, to his credit, actually did stand up. This woman's name is Liz Burney. She's like the Zionist Organization of America. She wouldn't even criticize Trump for the anti-Semitism that surrounds him. She was like, where were you people during Obama when Obama was – she's claiming Obama was anti-Semitic. This is the Zionist Organization of America. And I've told Alex, do not rejoin that organization. Cancel your car. He won't stop it. He won't stop it with the next year in Jerusalem.
Here's why I'm proud to be Jewish. 80% of American Jews, maybe a tiny bit fewer, 80% of American Jews hate Donald Trump. Is that a fair statement?
They also hate Alan Dershowitz.
Alan Dershowitz hates Alan Dershowitz. The reason I think that's a pretty good number for a religion.
Absolutely. Absolutely. How can you be in favor? How can any Jew be in favor of subjugating a people for any reason to believe that's going forward a good system? Is that these does it remind you of anything? Perhaps we were subjugated. I have a memory of previous subjugation.
Queen Esther?
Hello?
Queen
Am
Esther?
I still on?
Are you Purim? Did something happen in the 30s I didn't hear about?
Now, you watch Bill Maher, I'm assuming. I mean, that was the worst thing I've ever seen in my life.
Let me set this up.
I know you like Milo. Stop sending me the brochures about Milo. I don't want to hear any more of your pro-Milo material. You think he's funny. You love his sight gags. You love his pearls.
He has a pearl necklace. Usually when Milo has a pearl necklace, he's leaving a men's room.
And no offense, not that there's anything wrong with that, but what is the worst act? It's just on a basic how horrible he is at what he does. He's not even a good hate monger, that guy. I can't believe that guy is. He's so rich. Who would give him a book deal? Who gives him a book deal besides Simon and Schuster?
You didn't hear the opening of my show.
No, you know what happened here? No, I didn't hear the opening of the show, and I didn't hear the cold open to my segment. You said something about Mika Fox or something. I pulled the headphone out of my ear like a Jew on the shuffleboard court in Miami. When he finds out when he has something, he's rubbing suntan lotion on his puppet.
Puppet. For those of you who are a puppet is your schwanz. But it's a tiny schwanz, right? It's a schmeckle.
That's your belly button.
Oh,
your belly button.
Wait a second. Then my father molested me. It's your belly button? Oh, my God.
I think so. Maybe I'm wrong.
I think you're right. Your puppet. I think you're right. Your puppet is your belly button. Yeah, I think you're right. But I have to call
everything else means penis.
Yes.
Everything else means penis.
Shalom.
Putz.
Shalom.
Shalom means penis.
So you didn't hear the opening of the show where I went off on Bill Maher. And this is my complaint about Bill Maher and Milo Yiannopoulos. They both.
How do you say it?
I don't know. Milo is calling himself a Jew. What I briefly saw in Bill Maher, he identifies as a gay Jew.
Oh, I thought he said he was a Catholic.
He is, but he's doing what Bill Maher does. Whenever Bill Maher is incendiary, he brings up the fact that his mother's a Jew.
He's throwing it all in.
Yeah, like we need them to make our life any worse than it already is.
God,
you can't be a Jew by convenience, right?
No, you can't be a Jew by convenience. You know what the other thing that bothers me? I'm watching this HBO documentary, which is a really good documentary. It's called Valentine's Day. It's about a transgender kid, and he got murdered in the school in Oxnard, and it's a whole long story, but they're talking about these, like, neo-Nazis, you know? And it's like Bill Maher's whole thing that the only thing to worry about is Muslims. We should forget that there was Oklahoma City. Forget the who's the guy, Breivik, Andre Breivik.
Right, in Norway.
Yeah. Yeah, forget that. It's only the Muslims that we have to worry about. It's so brain dead stupid. He's such a, that's the thing, it's amazing. This guy hosts a show and he's a moron. He is not a bright man. I'm not saying he's not an intelligent man, but he does not use his brain. He's intellectually lazy. He knows nothing about religion. He thinks when he had Leah Remini on last night, it's like a religion could be a cult. Not all cults are religions. You know, when you go, you may not like the Catholic Church, but they don't tell you, I'll give you some information that when you give me $1 million, I'll give you another Bible when it's $2 million. I mean, his knowledge of what he hates is so limited, it's distressing to me. Add a joke to it.
No, it's okay. I think I don't watch the show anymore, and I'm not.
Neither did I until the last three.
Right. I'm not you. I'm going to give you a compliment. I said this to you, and I mean this, and we'll get funny again in a second.
On Shavuos.
It's very easy to do political humor. It's very easy for somebody like me to attack Donald Trump. It's very easy for me to go after ExxonMobil on a podcast that doesn't run commercials. There's nothing brave here. For a comedian to attack the people who could hire him, for a comedian to go after Louis C.K.
Right.
You are the bravest, because you're funny, you're the bravest comic out there. You're fearless.
That's so nice of you to say, and I'm very touched. Well, I never even used the word touched. I'm moved. That's a very sweet thing.
It's a fact.
And it makes me feel better about the fact that I don't have a pot to piss in. Because Louis C.K. all of a sudden is manufacturing piss pots. And I...
He
won't let me buy one even if I could buy one.
And I remember, because I remember when I first met you, we had coffee with Eddie Krasnick. I was headlining the Improv in San Francisco, and I was more famous than you at the time, and I remember giving you advice about comedy.
I remember that week, though.
Yeah.
A lot.
Yeah.
I remember that week.
And I was, you know, very giving you bits, and I didn't know how funny you were because you were, you know, being coy with me.
I don't think I was America's sweetheart then.
No, you weren't.
Of comedy.
And I remember thinking, boy, you know, why is he attacking people who can help him? That's how mercenary I am, thinking.
That's so funny because I don't even remember. I think I was just doing it on a petty basis at that point. It wasn't even professional. It was more like, who's that guy, Rick Reynolds? How does he get a one-man show?
Right. And Bruce Smirnoff had the best one-man show, right?
Bruce Smirnoff's one-man. Now, you're not being sarcastic. I loved his one-man show.
It was the
right?
best. There was a time about 1995 when every comic was doing a one-man show. And Bruce Smirnoff had the single best one-man show. I remember taking my father to see that. And I saw it like five times. And Bruce Smirnoff's one-man show was hands down the funny, right?
Well, he would show a picture of himself with a Jufro, and then he showed a picture of this woman that was his dream woman,
mm-hmm.
and he said something like, if I can't be with a woman like this, I'm going to be alone. Guess what? I'm alone. And, of course, he did have the weasel, Pop Goes the Weasel joke is the there's no better joke than that.
And he was willing at the time to do kind of what you do, in that he exposed Johnny Carson when Johnny had just gone off, Johnny was a saint. You never said anything bad about Johnny.
Yeah.
Bruce Smirnoff was the first one to tell the truth about Johnny Carson and Carol O'Connor.
Oh, I don't remember. Oh, that's right. The Carol O'Connor story. And you know what? How some people, like, you know, your Kathy Griffin will tell a story and you go, how much of this is true? Very little, because she looks way better than everybody else. I believe every detail of both the Carson story and the Carol O'Connor story are true.
Right. And we love Kathy Griffin, right?
No.
Oh, you know, I love. Am I wrong?
Oh, she hates me. She hates me.
Weren't you close friends with her?
Yes.
Oh, so that's a personal thing, but in terms of
it's a personal thing,
right?
Personal. Yeah.
And
no. Let me finish. Kathy Griffin.
Yeah,
that's the kind of person that we should have in comedy more. Forget the other stuff.
Oh, I like Kathy Griffin. I do.
She's a. You know what you should do, just as a joke, just cross her once. See how that works out.
Well, I don't get close. I don't know if you've noticed this, but I don't get close to people.
I haven't seen you in the same room with a person since 19 bing. Now, David's laughing. I got 19 bing from David. That is David's joke.
Really?
Yes. You said you used to love those comics who would say, you know, well, I started comedy back in 19 bang. You don't remember?
No,
that's your joke.
I think I said
our early bits.
I think on Yom Kippur, I said I'm still writing 6-2 bing on my checks.
Hey, you know, Mel Gibson is 2017. Mel Gibson is still writing "I hate the Jews" on his checks.
So you can now purchase. I'm not plugging this stadium.
Oh yeah, but do plug it. Now, why don't you plug it? Should be. I mean, I'm not getting paid for this appearance.
I know. That's why.
I mean, I was told there was a lot of money in being a radio guest years ago. Haven't seen a dime.
Okay. I want to get to this because I want to. It's part of a larger point. If I go to iTunes, which I'm going to do after the show, to purchase this,
it's not a physical store. It's not near the Apple store, David. You have to use a computer.
Okay. And it's a song. It's tunes, right? So you're singing this?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. You have to click on – first of all, you have to sing State of the Industry into your computer microphone. First, you have to insert your AOL CD from 1987.
Remember they used to show up, you'd get an AOL CD in the mail, and you'd say, how can they afford this, right?
I know, it's unbelievable. They must be made of money over there. The first time I saw that, I said, this is so impressive, they should buy Time Warner.
Mm-hmm. They should buy, that's right. And
is that how old my references are? Is that what it is?
No, but that's whenever you hear Donald Trump say, let's privatize Social Security, let's privatize our medicine, always remember that Gerald Levin, the genius at HBO, and Steve Case, the guy who dreamed up AOL, Time Warner, and that should tell you how brilliant people with money are. So
to Ted Turner's credit, he hated the idea of the deal. He also hated what happened to CNN too. Yeah. Some parts of Ted Turner I admire.
Yeah, but I think deep down he's still
he'll tear your throat out. He'll tear your throat out to get an ice cream cone. Don't get me wrong.
But in his defense, it's a really good tasting ice cream cone.
He'll take a union guy to knock the union head off the off of a building. He'll do that. Let's not kid ourselves.
But in his defense, he gave us Tush and Tesh. Wasn't there a
he
show?
He would dig up. Who's the guy who they buried? He'd dig up Hoffa and bury you next to him if it saves him $3 on a residual.
All right, what do I type into iTunes? What is the title of this?
Oh, my God. This is the longest plug I've ever. People are, you know what they're not going to want to do after this is over? They're going to feel like they've already heard the state of the industry with you hocking them.
This plug.
Do you realize that most people who are listening to this have already downloaded it, Dave? While you're getting a cup, let me get a cup of coffee. Let me get my leg warmers on.
This plug is more unseemly than what's on top of Senator Proxmire's head.
I don't want to say this plug. This is a bad plug. But Travolta rejected it.
What do I, in order to hear Andy Kindler's 1996 Just for Laughs State of the Industry speech on iTunes, I guess I will type in Andy Kindler. Most people, believe it or not, do not know that every year you give a State of the Industry speech at the Montreal Comedy Festival. It is the most highly attended event at the Montreal Comedy Festival. You look back at comedy and you rip a new one and you expose comedians and agents and managers for what they are. Nobody is safe at the – why did you pick 1996?
Okay, so the reason why I picked 1996 was I felt – well, first of all, that many of my feuds – I wanted a lot of my feuds from the 90s to reach a larger audience. That was my first goal. The reason is because that was happens to be the first year of the speech. So this company, Comedy Dynamics, they approached us and they said, do you want to release one? So my manager said, why don't we just listen to the first one, see how it sounds? And when I listened to the first one, I was pleasantly surprised because my image is that I always like, you know, think I'm, you know, better now than I was then and all that kind of stuff. But I was really happy with how it was. And also, it was fascinating to me to see who I had grudges against then. And, you know, it was and it was the first of many Leno jokes where I said Leno's in the Guinness Book of Records for going the longest period of time without having an authentic moment. And it was the first year of the speech, so it was like kind of a who knew how it would turn out. It just happened to be that the first year was a success.
How many minutes
and
is it? How many minutes?
It's about – I think it's slightly under an hour.
See, this is the first time – because this has become the main event at the Montreal Comedy Festival every year. So it was 1996. Did you think it was going to become a tradition?
No. I had no idea. I did know once – see, what happened was I wrote an article for National Lampoon called The Hack Comics Handbook, which is still on my website if people want to see it. And then I did a live demonstration in Montreal with, like, Blake Patch and Patton Oswalt, all these comics, and we demonstrated how to be a bad comic. And then the head of the festival said, try something else the next year, and I tried to save the industry, and then the first – it went really well. I had a feeling because it went so well, they would – we would do it again next year, but I had no idea it would be 20 years. And not only was it 20 years, but I mean, there were a couple of years I actually cried. It was so horrible.
What do you mean?
It was just, you know, there were the first few years was like, it was a novelty type thing. And so they always did pretty well. But then the first time it just, for some reason, didn't go or whatever, you know, it's like, I can't even explain it. Just hit or miss. I was like almost sobbing, and it happened one more time at the new hotel where the festival is because they put me in the long rectangular room where the people in the back were watching me on screens, and I remember crying after that. I remember crying after that. But I have, after 20 years, I have gotten a formula that I'm fairly confident won't die.
Right. The Delta was the old hotel.
Right. Right.
When I remember – anyway, that's so.
You remember, both of us were up for a cup of coffee in show business. Is that what they said?
So you're a purist.
I had a cup of coffee with the Phillies in '93.
You're a purist. You believe, and Alex Brazell, who you know, he is my boss. I had an incident with him, and I want to ask you for advice.
Is this true?
Yes, yes. So I want to ask you for advice. Alex Brazell.
It is not. It is non-paycheck. This is late.
Alex has impeccable taste when it comes to comedy. He's 28 years old. I'm sorry? Are you there?
He does, and he's bright. He's brilliant. The guy's got a mind. I wish I had his brain at 28.
So we were at a club, and I was performing, and we saw a comic. And I said, book him. Book him for the podcast. This guy's really funny. And Alex goes, F him, he's a hack. I said, I think he's brilliant. Nah, he's a hack. Everything he says has already been done. And I went, wow, that's okay. He's killing with the crowd. I mean, all right, Alex, you book the show. I'm like, you know better than I. And then to Alex's credit, he sent me the next day. I'll say he was on Conan, right?
Yeah.
I'm not trashing Conan. He was on Conan the next night. And to Alex's credit, he said, I guess I was wrong. And I wrote back, or maybe Conan is wrong. You know?
Right.
But then I had this long conversation with Alex, and I said unto him that it's great to be a purist, but on a day-to-day existence, when you're grinding out life, there's the ideal, and then there's what you have to do, right? But you are an ideal.
Is this what you said before you pitched Full House? Bringing back Full House? Fuller House?
And that's the difference between you and me. And I think to some degree, we've never had a feud. I don't think you care enough about me to have. I think you view me a bit, and I am. I've compromised. And you have.
No, that's. Nobody thinks you've comp. Who thinks. Nobody thinks that. Who would. What? It's not like you're. First of all, what do you like? Like you're playing Chachi on a sitcom or something like that? I mean, are you Mr. Belvedere or something?
But you are a purist. And so.
I'm a purist, but, you know, when I was completely broke, I took a job as a judge on Last Comic Standing.
That was the year that I was. I did it. You don't remember.
Oh, that's right. That's right. That's right. But I said to myself, I'm going to do it, but I'm not going to do it like a Simon Cowell. I'm going to try to have respect for myself.
Right.
So, but you have to make a living, but I wouldn't do, you told me years ago you would have appeared in Nazi propaganda films if you had the chance. Because you said to me, I'll never forget, you said, look, somebody has to play the Jew. Somebody has to play the Jew. That's from my act, kids. That's from my act, 1993.
Oh, my God. Well, so, first of all, I have a couple of questions I want to ask you. You can answer them flippantly or not. By the way, this is when I knew my marriage was in trouble. My kids and my then-wife came to see me. It was in Glendale. And everybody told me not to do this joke on Last Comic Standing. I was in the semifinals. And like a schmuck, I thought I was going to go all the way. I always, on Star Search, I do these roast battles. I always think I'm going to win. Well, I was moving up because Greg Giraldo and you were the judges. And I figured, my checks are clearing. Are you breathing into the microphone?
Oh, I'm sorry. No, I am because I'm holding the microphone close. But I shouldn't be breathing that much.
Well, what's making me hard?
I didn't even know. Are you divorced? I didn't even know you were divorced. Are you divorced now?
I didn't even know I was married. Yeah, I'm divorced. Yes.
I'm sorry to hear that. I'm very sorry to hear that.
Why? You're the reason.
Because it seemed... I just happened to be naked in your garage.
I have to, but you?
Your wife said she lost something in her vagina. That's all it was.
See, I'm shocked to hear you even say the word vagina. Because that's
I actually twinged a little bit.
Yeah, because you're By the way, I have to, but you is what you mentioned up at the top. The guy comes home, he sees his best friend banging his wife, and he goes, Saul, I have to, but you? It's one of the great jokes.
So good.
You know the one,
put
me down for three?
No, how many times did you have sex with the wife?
In order to save, the woman's dying, and the doctor says, in order for her to live, you have to... have to have sex with her 15 times a week, and the husband goes, put me down for three.
You know what's amazing? I've never found out what that disease was that required 15 fornications a week. That's what I've never...
hang on, man. I'm like getting dizzy. Seriously, there's a certain... Okay, hang on. The room is spinning. I'm being serious. Hang on.
I had that happen to me. I actually believe that proves the existence of God when you have that hyperventilating experience.
Yeah.
Oh, that's what I think.
Okay, so my question for you... So last comic standing, I knew my marriage was over because I had a joke where I insulted women and then I said, hey, I love women. I just performed at a battered women's shelter. Of course, I bombed because they wouldn't listen. And so I was doing this up until like 4 years ago, and it's a joke off a joke. Taking a joke, you know, why are there so many battered women? Because they just won't listen. So that's an actual street joke. And then I did a variation on it. And it was dumb, and the person who I was married to and my kids said, Daddy, don't do that joke. And I go, but it's funny. And one of my daughters goes, it's a joke off a joke, and it's revealing that you're pro-beating women. And I used to do it. Remember Karen Rentowski? She does those battered women shelters.
Yeah.
I used to do the joke of battered women shelters, and it would kill. That's why I've never made it, because I did. You know, I never understood... Anyway, you're a purist. You're a purist. You grew up. Go ahead.
Right.
You grew up as a fan of comedy. Are you able to enjoy bad comedy? Then I'll shut up. And by the way, that's going to be the name of this show. Then I'll shut up. Are you able to watch a bad comic because he's so bad he's funny? And are you able to watch a bad comic and enjoy him just because his heart is in the right place? He's a hack, but he's not hurting anybody.
Well, the latter example I wouldn't enjoy because I wouldn't be laughing. So, I mean, I wouldn't like boo the guy, but there's no way I could say enjoy him. I could feel bad for him. Feel empathy, but it wouldn't be like I go, well, I couldn't laugh, which is how I think is the main way to enjoy a comic.
Right.
One of the top three ways. Now, in the former, or number one, or A, mm-hmm. I used to be addicted to bad comedy. I used to play the Riviera Hotel mm-hmm. when Steve Sciarippa was the entertainment director, mm-hmm. and he would get me all of these headshots of all these crazy, there was an Al B. Shore impersonator. And how would you even know what Al B. Shore looked like or sounded like to know if the impersonation was dead on?
Who was Al B. Shore?
I used to love these terrible acts. I used to love it. And then I got burnt out on it because then that's what the comedy became in the 90s. So now I don't like it as much. Like, I used to be able to watch Evening at the Improv and just the worse it was, the better, you know? Mm-hmm. So everything was an attitude on steroids from hell. What part of the McNuggets, the chicken, does the McNuggets come from? All the classics.
So you do not forgive bad comedy?
No, I mean, I might like to watch a Jeff Dunham to get enraged by the racism.
Is it so?
I don't mind the carrot. I mean, I don't mind. I won't yell at carrot. You know what? I think I could probably watch Gallagher Because Gallagher looks like you could watch him and he might do something so horribly bad that it could cheer you up.
See, I'll defend Carrot Top. My sister, of all people, sent me...
Is Carrot Top.
I do the gay Carrot Top. I'm Carrot Bottom. That's... I can't believe you. I made Andy laugh. I can't believe it. That's so bad.
I love Carrot Top on the radio. That's one of my favorite things. I'm holding a tennis racket up to a toaster right now, and it's a tennis racket toaster. If you're on the court and you want to get hungry, you just pop the toaster. I tied it to the tennis racket with a very, very tight bungee cord.
I'm going to defend Carrot Top. My sister sent me him on Fox News and was outraged by it. And I thought, he's not hurting anybody except himself.
Really? Why don't you use – he'll want that as a poll quote. That's really glowing. Forward by Dave Feldman. He's not hurting anybody.
So as a Jew, I have a
– yes.
I'm going to tread on dangerous water here. You don't necessarily have to answer the question. We're the people of the word, right? We like the word, and we're readers, and we like jokes. But there's more to comedy than jokes. Are you able to get past what somebody is saying when you're watching a comedian? Because most comedy, especially now, is, Angela and I were talking earlier about authenticity and storytelling and revealing who you are as a person. You're able to enjoy somebody who is more about attitude than they are about what they're saying. Are you able to enjoy attitude?
Well, yeah, but I mean, there's also been people, you know, I could make the argument that, like, I'm a huge Rickles fan. I think Rickles is more attitude than the actual material.
Exactly.
But then some of the things he says are pure gold with the actual words are amazing, you know. But he also has a funny attitude. So I think, I can definitely appreciate when if it's not but I can't appreciate something that's – I don't like things that are like, well, it's not my cup of tea, but I appreciate it. That I don't like.
And the great thing about Rickles was he didn't have jokes. You can't write for Rickles. He was totally in the moment. Are you judging
And he was so great on panel. He was so great on panel when he would go on Letterman and Carson.
Right. He was kind of the opposite coin of Jonathan Winters in that it's
right.
The same thing, totally unprepared. He's basically got nothing. And so you realize when Rickles is doing panel, he is – completely unprepared, has nothing, and will make mistakes. So it's that high wire act that we appreciate. When you judge comedy, are you judging the degree of difficulty?
Well, people say that they ask me that when they look down at my scorecard.
Do you
know that I score the act? I say that joke was 5-4-3 double play.
What did you say in 1996 that you were right about and you were wrong about?
That's interesting you say that because I have examples of both. I offered $1 million for footage of Whoopi Goldberg being funny. What year is it, David? What year is it? In today's dollars, I would be offering $20 million.
By the way,
I was right. Yeah.
I have heard that, what you just said, probably 1,000 times from people quoting you, but I've never actually heard you say it. That's the first I've heard that 1,000. Andy Kindler is willing to pay $1 million to anybody. Yeah, that's amazing. Okay, what were you wrong about?
Now, have you heard me do this one live? Who died and made Jim Belushi a big star? So here is what I was wrong about. What I was wrong about, which is why I think it's compelling to listen to it, because I've realized over the years that a lot of, you know, I may have, and people have pointed out to me, I may be sometimes occasionally angry about things. Mm-hmm. So and sometimes the anger is based on, and in the last few years of the speech, I've actually had fun bringing people in and saying, yeah, you know, it's based on my own envy and jealousy. So back then, I was had been bumped from Letterman, and I had had issues with Robert Morton. And so I was kind of like, and that was when they were saying that Letterman at 11:30, they're not going to do this. Like Robert Morton was saying, they can't do the same show as they did at 12:30. So I basically, during the speech, said, you know, Letterman should just go with, and it was kind of dumb in a way. Letterman should go with he shouldn't worry about what time slot it is. Well, I was wrong because eventually I think Letterman really did find his, I mean, it took a while because, I mean, I think he was always hilarious, but the stuff that happened with his heart, I felt like made a dramatic change, and the show became very similar to what it was when it started, you know?
Is it fair to say that of all, you were a regular on Letterman.
Right.
I think it's fair to say that you are the most daring comic to do Letterman. Maybe Hicks, but he didn't really do Dave on CBS. You were the biggest chance that he took.
You mean just by, you're just going by audience response, right?
And in terms of, no, I'm talking about appealing to, he wanted smooth comedy. He didn't want anything rough around the edges. He wanted money in the bank. And the exceptions he made were Kinison and Bill Hicks on the NBC show at 12:30. You were the only rough around the edges comic that was put on the show.
Well, I appreciate you saying that, but I would also make the argument that he did, because I think nobody has a better sense of humor than Letterman. So in other words, like, he loved Amy Sedaris, and Amy Sedaris didn't always kill, and mm-hmm. he would always, but she would kill to me. You know, I thought she was hilarious, but he always did like oddballs in a way. He loved Chris Elliott, obviously.
Right.
And Bonnie Hunt. So I think he did champion that. It just happened that Richard Lewis killed, but Richard Lewis was kind of a neurotic act at that point. So I think he always liked what he liked. I think that's whereas Leno absolutely is not comfortable with anybody being funny around him, because he has the Trump syndrome of down deep just having tremendous insecurities that he covers up with bravado.
Okay, can I get a little more time with you? Because this is really important to me.
Yes.
You're being very generous. This is a very generous gift that you're giving me by doing the show, and I cannot thank you enough. I started...
Well, Dave, you have to, but me?
So I started the show by saying that I think people shouldn't be getting their news from Bill Maher. And I'm going to bring this back to Letterman, so stick with me. I started the show by saying that Bill was wrong for having Milo Yiannopoulos on his show, because there's a live audience. It's like the Roman circus. You win by who gets the largest response. But the audience on Bill's show is partisan. So all Larry Wilmore had to do, and I saw overtime, was say to Milo.
Me too. Milo, I did too. Yeah. I've never watched it before.
Yeah. So Milo, you know, Larry Wilmore said F you, and the place went nuts. Yep. And I thought, well, you're not winning. You're not really moving the cause, because the people who believe in Milo Yiannopoulos are saying, well, there's a black guy, and the only thing he can say is F you. So you kind of.
Yeah, but I think he was also genuinely upset. I don't think he was trying to win with that comment.
Right.
You know?
And I said that, you know, I apologize, Andy, but I love Bill and I love the show, but I don't think it's.
Oh, I didn't know that. I didn't even know you liked the show.
I worked for him for years.
Let me finish.
I can get your book. Do you want to? No. And I think he's. I do.
Oh yeah, let's put this behind us. people like us, we can all be reasonable. Wouldn't you love me turning on a dime and becoming a sellout guy?
Yeah,
so good.
But so I don't believe that Bill is doing a comedy version of Meet the Press. And I think the problem when you have Milo Yiannopoulos on is there's an audience, and audiences are dangerous. When you're playing to an audience, you're not giving information. That had Bill gone one-on-one with Milo the way he went one-on-one with Obama, then you can have a discussion. But when it's a cluster F, a gangbang of everybody trying to get their points made, Milo is able to use sophistry, rhetorical devices to throw people off their game and help his cause. And that gets back to Letterman.
He did a one-on-one, I thought.
Well, I'm talking about the overtime that I saw. Yeah.
Yeah.
When you're doing it in front of an audience, it's dangerous. You did Letterman a lot. You were a regular on Letterman. You did panel. The audience changes your material. If there's an audience, you're going to do what gave you the courage? Because you know, the first time I began working with Alex Brazil, he said, "Let's watch some Kindler," and I would say, "We would watch you on Letterman." And I'd say, "This is I want to be a comedian when I watch Andy Kindler." You make me want to be a comedian, and not all your jokes work.
True.
What gives you the what gives you the courage to defy the mob?
Well, absolutely. It takes, you know, the only way it happened was by doing the show more than once, because the first time I was on Letterman, I really felt like I bombed because I couldn't be myself. So it really took. And in fact, I wouldn't say till 2005 when I had one breakthrough set. Now, I mean, I'm kind of not being truthful. I had breakout. I had like moments that were great, but I think it's a very. I mean, you would agree that the 6 minute format is not an easy format.
For me, it is because I do jokes.
You do like okay, so you like that?
Yeah.
I'm actually walking to the mailbox, so I'm sorry you guys are going to have to hear me outside.
Oh.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right, so.
Oh, wait. Hang on. Do the hack bit. You're walking to the mailbox. For you young kids. Hello?
Yeah.
For you young kids.
Yeah, well. Right.
The Beatles were a band that Paul McCartney played in before Wings. You get what I'm saying?
What'd you say? Say it again. Young kids, what?
Okay, you're walking in the mailbox. For you young kids, a mailbox is this thing that we used to.
Right.
Put
about email. Think about email as if it was a physical thing.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And you know what? I even have my headphones turned up, and I was here, and you were still too loud. But the thing is that I got after a while, I really clearly wrote every single set for him mostly because it didn't really matter after a while. To me, it didn't matter if the crowd didn't get stuff. And I'm not even saying that it was to be better if they did get stuff, if they didn't get stuff. But I absolutely wrote things that I thought would make him laugh,
mm-hmm.
or would make Paul laugh.
And were you okay? So this is fascinating to me, because, and I don't know if this still happens. I don't, you know, but when you were doing these shows, there were four audiences. There was Dave, there was Paul, there was the studio audience, and then there was the home audience. And how do you play to all four, right?
Well, the only, and I felt this way my entire life. If I am having a good time, it really doesn't matter to me how many people get it. Now, that being said, sometimes you can't create that. In other words, I can say to myself, I'm going to have a good time if only two people get it, but it just it doesn't even work on that level. But generally on Letterman, it really did work that that just making myself happy and trying to get Dave to laugh made the experience so much fun for me. Also, I think as he got more comfortable in that theater, I don't know how you feel, but I feel like as time went along, it really the crowds I felt were so much better. They were like the old crowds. Because when he went to first CBS at the beginning, I felt those crowds were so pumped up a lot. It didn't feel like Dave's show sometimes.
Right. I don't like – anyway, we'll move on. We should wrap it up because I'm being piggish with you. Will you come back?
I will, but let me ask you a question, though. Do you don't object to Mars anti-Muslim stuff, or is this a whole thing that we should get into?
I'll discuss it if you have time.
Maybe we'll pick it up next time.
Yes, I do object to his anti-Muslim stuff. And I wish he wouldn't identify as Jewish when he says it. I think it's reckless because he isn't Jewish.
Right.
And it's not how we were raised. It's not.
Right.
And it's dangerous. And I think it's a prosaic argument. It's just been around to debate religion. It's just incendiary for the sake of being incendiary. It's turning up the heat to make a buck. The fact is, and this is cliche, it's just I can't believe that I'm 58 years old and I'm having to say something that I said when I was in high school. For you kids listening, high school is a place where that you can go cherry pick Leviticus, the Old Testament, and find enough evidence to say that Judaism is a religion of hate. You can go read the book of John, Revelations, and say Christianity is a book of hate. And I find this...
It's so infantile an argument, right?
Yeah.
Isn't it so infantile?
Yeah.
It's like you're 5 years, it's like you're 6 years old and you finally realize that God is not a man who lives in the clouds.
Yeah.
And you're running around for the rest of your life. He thinks he's a genius that he's discovered this. It's like I've used the line, like, I don't sacrifice my first son because it says, you know, bring your first son to be sacrificed. But so I think we're on the same page. So I just want to say, please stop sending me. You keep sending me. You're rewriting the Muslim ban every day, and you keep sending me. You say I insist, Andy, that this is constitutionally sound. Just go back off of it already, David. Back off of it.
You know,
it's not going to pass. It's not going to pass muster.
Andy, we've stopped recording, by the way. So this is just between nobody's listening. This is between you and me. You know as well as I do that there are neighborhoods in Los Angeles and New York that you cannot walk through without being subjected to Sharia law. You know that. We've stopped tape. This is just, you know.
Okay. You know what? And since we've stopped tape, let's be honest and say we like Piers Morgan. We don't agree with everything he says. He's not perfect, but he brings a point of view that we appreciate.
We have to hear all sides. I always say, why? Why do we have to hear all sides?
Have we stopped tape?
Yes,
we
of course. Tape, yes, right? We've stopped tape.
Okay. Do you also have masturbate to memories of Eva Braun?
Yes.
Like I do.
Oh, my God. Yes. In the onesie bathing suit.
Right.
Uh-huh. That perfect Aryan body. Yes.
I don't want to push it, but Hitler's dog, does that get you going a little
Blondie?
Bit?
Blondie? Are you kidding? I love Blondie. By the way, why was Hitler's dog called Blondie? It was a German Shepherd. It wasn't blonde.
I don't even know if that's true. I thought you made that up.
No, Hitler had a German Shepherd named Blondie. What's up with that?
Okay, now we stopped tape, right?
Yeah, we stopped tape. Right? Yeah, of course.
Now this concept of incest. Is this a law? Is this something that can, if I have a cousin
mm-hmm.
who we're very friendly
mm-hmm.
and we embrace,
mm-hmm.
is that so bad? Have we stopped tape?
I want to ask you, have we stopped tape?
Right, how do you know if a man's dead? How do you know if he's really dead? If I shoot a man and it's not my gun and he aggravates me, am I liable on some level?
Yes, I agree. That's a great question that you can find. We've stopped tape, right?
I'm hoping we have, because I would not be speaking this way.
Yes.
If I thought that you were continuing to record the proceedings.
Right. We've stopped tape. You know as well as I do that if you go look up, if you read the Talmud, there are instructions on how to poison the wells of Christians. And we've stopped tape, right?
Yeah, we've stopped tape, right?
Have you noticed that the recipes for poison, it's really hard to get tiger eye drops these days? When the Talmud was written, it was written in Babylonia. They had access to tiger eye drops.
Right.
But these days, you would think, we've stopped tape, that...
Now, let me ask you a question.
Yes.
Now, we have stopped tape. So
yeah, absolutely, yes.
The fact that I smoke heroin,
mm-hmm.
that's better, right? It's markedly better.
Well, we've stopped tape.
We've
stopped tape. You know as well as I do that you could start shooting heroin and sharing needles. That the only way, we've stopped tape, by the way, to contract HIV. The only way to contract HIV is by having unnatural sex with another. We stopped tape, so it's...
Okay, now we stopped tape, right?
Yeah,
because let me ask you a question.
Sure.
My wife complains because I can't get a full erection.
Mm-hmm.
And I say, me hitting my half-flaccid penis against her thigh counts as sex. You tell me if it's good.
We've stopped tape. Yeah. We've stopped tape. My mother says the same thing when I'm having...
She said that to me. We stopped tape because your mother last night...
Yes.
After we had sex...
Yes.
We've stopped tape, right?
Yeah, we've stopped tape.
She starts complaining to me. She starts telling me her problems.
Uh-huh.
I don't go home to fuck your mother to hear about her problems with your Aunt Yeti.
We've stopped tape, right?
Have we stopped tape?
We've stopped tape. Have you tried turning my mother over so her face is into a pillow?
I'm so nervous. I swear to God, all I'm nervous now is that you're going to play that goddamn flaccid penis. You cannot play that flaccid penis. That cannot be.
Oh, no, we're not taping
that
this.
That one. Oh, good. Okay, because I want to say, am I wrong that I tie a splint to my flaccid penis? Well, I don't know why it seems so funny to me to do more dick jokes on the premise that we're not. We stopped tape, right? Because my penis is 1 inch from the floor. hey, David, if we stopped tape, because I don't know if I ever told you that my penis has a tattoo on it. It says Shorty's, but then when it gets hard, it gets Shorty's Pizzeria. We deliver, ask about our calzones. Open Tuesdays through Sundays. Ask for Morty. Parties are our specialty. Call our fax number, www.shorties.net.com.
So I get
it erect.
So basically what we're saying is that
right.
Bill Maher has an obligation to his audience to deliver sophisticated, highbrow analysis of the news and to do comedy that elevates.
Right.
We've stopped tape. Hey, Andy Kindler.
This was so great.
You're the best. I'm not going to say you're the best because everybody says that. I am going to thank you for coming on my show. Once again, this was an absolute gift. Angela Cobb is here. She's been sitting here patiently.
Hello.
When you come to New York, I'm going to introduce...
Oh, I'm sorry, Angela.
That's okay.
Angela is one of the funniest young comics coming up in New York. And is there a question you have for Andy? Because I've hogged all the time.
After all this, I have too many questions to ask.
Well, ask him one question.
No, have you guys done the Did You Stop Tape thing before?
No.
It's cute. It's like it reminded me of like a vaudeville thing. It was cute.
If I had known you were there, I would have not been so graphic.
Oh, it's okay.
Because I have an infection. I would not have mentioned, for example, that I have had an infection since I was in the Navy.
I didn't know you were a seaman.
Okay, I'm going to let you go. I hope I get to meet you one day, Angela.
Yes,
and
thank
you,
so,
you
much.
So much.
Thank you so much.
I love you. Thank you. This was a major gift. Thank you.
Have fun.
Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye.
Andy Kindler, go to iTunes and purchase his 1996 Just for Laughs State of the Industry speech on iTunes. I promise you, you will laugh. And it'll be really interesting because it was 21 years ago. And he is fearless who he goes after. Hey, so Micah Fox canceled, right, Alex? And is Lori Kilmartin going to call in from the airport?
No.
She's not calling in. Is Jon Ross on the line?
Let's get Jon Ross on the line.
Is he?
Let's get him on the line.
Did he respond?
Let's call him up.
Do you have his number?
Yes.
Or how long? This show, we've probably, Angela, how are you holding up?
I'm good.
What did you think of Andy Kindler?
He's awesome.
He's the best. That was a hard booking. It's not easy to get Andy Kindler.
Well, that's good.
All right. We got Jon Ross on the line. Jon, listen.
David.
Yes, sir. Let me introduce you first.
Okay, go ahead.
Comedian. I just found out that Dana Gould said on Marc Maron that his biggest influence as a stand-up was Jon Ross. And we had Dana on our Friday show. Jon Ross.
I heard that.
You called we started in comedy together in San Francisco. You want to correct some information.
First of all, I want to say I'm very nervous to be on your show.
Good.
Doing the David Feldman podcast is like doing Carson in 78. My life is going to change. The phone is going to start ringing. And, everything is going to happen for me after this.
It's so big. It's big, baby.
I'm just trying to be prepared. Yeah.
Welcome to the big time.
So you were telling that story about the competition in, what was it, 84? Now, my memory of it is slightly different. It was at the Punchline. The first night was always at the Punchline.
I know.
In San Francisco.
Yes, you're right.
Right?
You're right.
And I was not in it that year. I had just come down to watch the first night with a bunch of other guys. I think Warren Thomas was there. And we were hanging out in that back room. And you were pacing around. And you were going, I need an opening line. I need an opening line. Which was absurd to be coming up with your opening line moments before you're going to do this thing. I mean, you have months to prepare for this idiotic competition.
What year is
this? Walking around going, you tell me. Was 80, it 84 80, or 5
think,
or
I think it was
80, I don't know.
I think it was 84. Go ahead.
That sounds about right. I had done the competition, I think, the year before and completely crapped out. And I Clint Eastwood in Magnum Force. A man has got to know his limitations. So I didn't. Wasn't Steve Kravitz in that movie?
Mm-hmm.
Right? Didn't he play a hoodlum?
Mm-hmm.
Right? Do you remember? I remember that. He got a small part in that movie, and then it was for a little bit, his shit didn't stink, and he was going to take off and be a movie star. And it's and the same thing with wasn't it Billy Jay? Didn't he do some small part in a Dustin Hoffman movie or something?
Billy Bathgate.
Billy Bathgate. Yeah, Billy Bathgate. And do you remember that? And he had all these scenes, and he was walking around talking about, and he was just ready. His career was going to take off. And then you see the movie, and he's completely cut out of it. He walks through one scene, doesn't say anything.
Billy Jay, actually, he's part of this story, if I remember correctly.
Is he?
Go ahead, yeah.
I don't. Anyway. Anyway, so you're going, I need an opening line. And so Steve Pearl says, now Steve Pearl's not trying to help you. Steve Pearl is just like Steve Pearl always, he's just trying to be funny. And so he like is going to come up with what is the worst possible opening line ever. And so he says, why don't you go up and say, doesn't all music suck? And it was like a bullseye. Like he said the one thing that virtually no human being on the planet could agree with. He came up with the absolute worst opening line possible. And so the rest of us were like hilarious. We like cracked up. We're like, oh, God. Funny, and your eyes lit up when everybody started laughing, and you're looking around going, "Ooh, ooh, that's funny." It's not a funny joke. It's funny as the worst opening line in history. And so you were like, "Ooh, ooh, I'll do that." And you said you were going to do it, and I don't think any of us—I certainly didn't believe you were going to do it. I thought you were putting us on, like saying, "Oh yeah, I'll do that." And then you walk on stage, and you go, "Doesn't all music suck?" And the people stared at you like, oh, this is going to be funny. What's this a setup? But then there was nothing else. And they just sat there and they like looking at you and you're looking at them and that was it. And it was like somebody had splashed water in your face and you woke up from a dream. You were like, what? It was the funniest. Like, and then me and Warren Thomas, because we're in the back of the room. Like laughing hysterically, and then like you could see like the moisture in your body, in your mouth, like evaporate, and you were just like dry, like you're like Ralph Cramden, hamina. It was hilarious. It was so funny, but it was just the idea that you heard us laughing and thinking, "Ooh, that's funny. Everyone's laughing. Mm-hmm. I'll do that." Oh my God, that was so fantastic!
Well, you forgot the tag to doesn't.
Oh, and then you said, "Well, it does." It was by that point, like you know, you were at the bottom of the ocean. It didn't matter. It was there was nothing you could say. Oh,
and what was the accidental byproduct of that evening? Go fast forward a month after I came in 40th. Out of 40 in the competition. You mentioned Billy Jay and Steve Kravitz.
Yeah.
What happened after that? I know.
What?
You had said to me, you were drunk.
Oh.
Go ahead.
Is that when I told you to put on the clown suit?
You said to me, and you weren't being mean, you were kind of joking about how bad that set was, and you were making fun of my complete and utter lack of charisma. And you said, your act is so unlikable. Your demeanor with your button-down shirt and your horn-rimmed glasses and your hair plugs and your effete East Coast intellectual snobbery, there is nothing you can do to make an audience like you. You are.
Okay.
Go ahead. Let me finish. Hang on. You said that. Hang on. This is how I remember it. That you.
That's important.
You are a New York Jew in the age of Reagan. There's nothing you can do to. If you put on a clown suit, they would still hate you.
Wow. All right. What's interesting is that's what you heard
mm-hmm.
in your head.
Mm-hmm.
What I said was, hey, you know what would be funny? If you put on a clown suit. You heard all the other stuff. That was inferred in your head that I was saying, you are so unlikable. You hear that even when it's not being said. But, you know, maybe with body language I was saying that. But what I said was the funny – because, you know, you – it was like a lecture. You would go, Ronald Reagan.
Raymond Donovan.
Nancy Reagan. She's about as much fun as a sneeze in the middle of a piss. And just the idea of this surly clown spouting political jokes was seemed hilarious to me. And I thought, you know what? Why not? Put on a glove. I might have said, you're not going anywhere anyway.
Mm-hmm.
I may have said something like that.
Zero charisma.
I said, you know,
zero.
I don't know. Look.
So I.
Well, I may have been drunk. That's true.
Okay, so Billy J. We went to a bar where they served ungape. Remember ungape? Which was some kind of.
Oh my God! Yeah.
Right. We were there, and it was Steve Kravitz and you. This is how I remember it. And I think Billy J., who I love, and nobody could rip me a new one like Billy J. When Billy was on one, he would, and he said to me, kind of like what you said, there's nothing like a but. And so it was your idea that I should wear a clown suit. And I was opening for Billy J. And then we have to wrap it up, Alex. I know, because we're out of time. I was opening for Billy J. and Steve Kravitz at Foo Bars, which is in Pleasanton, California. And everybody said they would love me if I wore a clown suit. That's why I did that joke, you know? Doesn't all music say? Because I wanted you guys to like me.
Sure.
So I realized, oh, well, then they'll like, if I put on a clown suit, then they'll like me. So Steve Kravitz and Billy J., I should probably call Kravitz, we went to a costume shop and we picked out my clown suit. I had a bald fright wig. It was a Bozo. I dressed like Bozo the Clown.
Yeah.
And Billy J. was the headliner, and I went up as Feldo the Clown at Foo Bars.
How did it go over? How did it go over?
The first, this is the God's honest truth, Tom Sawyer gave me a bit. He said, go up there with Jack Daniels, don't shave. Here's a shot glass, because Tom was booking Foo Bars at the time. And he gave me this bit, and it was real Jack Daniels. Hey, boys and girls, Feldo the Clown's going to do a trick. Watch me make this shot of Jack Daniels disappear. And I would pour the Jack Daniels and do a shot of it. That's magic. And that killed. And then I kind of lowered my voice and started doing my anti-Reagan stuff, and it killed. The first time I did it, it killed. And it spread throughout the comedy community. And Ann Fox, who ran the comedy competition, she had felt bad about how I had done in the comedy competition. She started writing about it in the Just for Laughs magazine. It just spread across the comedy community in Boston, New York. It just spread. There's a guy.
It was a good idea.
Right. It became. There's a guy, a Jew, who's doing political humor in a clown suit. And that was the last time it was funny. I swear to God.
Well, I was always of the impression, like, you know, I know that watch this drink disappear is a funny thing. I thought you should never mention it. Like, you should never even allude to the fact that you're in a clown suit. You
right.
just walk up to you, ladies and gentlemen, and just do the political material, but you're in a clown suit.
Which is what
that's
I did.
What I thought.
And that's what I did.
Yeah.
That's what I did. I wore the clown. I wore the clown suit for about 2.5 years, doing political humor, and I bombed every night. It never worked. But everybody loved the idea. Everybody loved
the idea. I get it.
And so I was getting booked. My calendar filled up, and it was a nightmare because I got what I wanted. But it wasn't, I knew, and there was nothing I can do. And I was getting money to play adult birthday party. I would go into people's homes.
And, really?
Yes. And I would get booked. Hey, there's a guy, he wears a clown suit, he does play. And so I was doing like private parties, and I was making some coin, and it was a disaster. It was like getting, it was being cast in Charles in Charge, as, you know, playing a flamboyant gay guy on Charles in Charge and being stuck and knowing it's you're getting paid. And and finally, I just had to take it off.
You know what I think?
Yeah.
I think it was a timing thing. I think the time for it is right now.
You really think so?
I think you should put the clown suit back on now.
Really?
Yes.
Will people like me?
Absolutely.
Will you respect
me? Absolutely.
So I can hang out with the...
Absolutely.
Seriously?
Do you have the suit, though?
I have the suit. So in other words, when I come into the club, I can sit with you guys if I wear the clown suit?
That thing should go to the Smithsonian.
I have to wrap it up. We have to... Two things.
Yeah.
It was very Warren Thomas. I can't even bring up Warren right now because that's a whole other show. But
we needed to do it before the election. Now everything is it's hard to just spend time talking about something that's just fun and frivolous like that. But
Warren and I,
not necessarily frivolous.
Warren and I were playing a club, and I drank. I used to drink, and when I wore the clown suit, I drank whatever you put in front of me, and I was waiting to go on, and I was fighting with my then girlfriend in the clown suit with a shot of Jack Daniels in my hand, and we're just going, and she walks away, and I take a shot of Jack Daniels, and I turn to Warren, and I go, I don't know what the hell I'm going to do with her. And he just busts out laughing. And I go, what? Yeah. I'm having, and he cannot stop laughing. And I go, what are you laughing at? He said, you're in a clown suit. I go, yeah, that's right. I completely forgot. I mean, there were times when I would drive to gigs in the clown, the comics would pick me up, and I'd be all right. Jon Ross, I love you. We're out of time. Thank you for correcting that. And I did forget until you called. Two things. One is it was your idea for me to wear the clown suit. I forgot that.
That is true.
It was your idea, and I forgot that Dana Gould had told Marc Maron that you were his biggest influence.
I think he might have said one of. I don't think I ever heard the show, but people told me. I don't. He might have said I was one of his influences, something like that. I don't know.
And I mentioned I mentioned briefly to Dana one of my many nervous breakdowns from doing stand-up comedy, and I literally had if you had videotaped it, you would say this is a clinical nervous breakdown. This guy is rolling around on the floor. And I know, and Dana joked and said, but you've had your share of what are, as a comedian, I won't say nervous breakdowns, but you've had your share of stupid. I wonder if those still exist with they probably do. I hope not. I hope that the millennials.
You mean in me or in young comics?
In young comics. I don't think the stakes are as high because it's been so diffused. You know, like there were in the 80s and 90s, there were make or break moments. Right?
Yeah, I suppose. But you're still dealing with that thing of, you know, putting yourself out there, going on stage in front of people, trying to say, this is my, you know, life, my career, what I want to try to do. And especially like we sort of had burned every bridge behind us. There was no going back, you know, and you're standing out there. And when you fucked it up, it was like, God, what do I do now? Like, I don't have any other options, you know?
And but there were, like you said, you jokingly said, I'm going to end the segment the same way we started. You said doing the David Feldman show is like doing Carson in 1978.
Yes.
Well, if you did Carson in 1978, it was make or break. Everything was riding on it. The whole world was watching.
Yeah.
And there were not just Carson, but there were things along the way, little stepping stones that were make or break moments. And if you broke, you went back five steps. There was a lot of pressure on you. I don't think we have those anymore. But maybe I'm wrong.
Very possibly not. I don't know. I'm not out there.
Right.
So I don't know.
And I think that's good. I don't think make or break moments are helpful. I think we've evolved past that. Jon Ross, I love you. When we have more time, we'll catch up. Okay.
Yeah, I'll come down to the city. I'm going to Germany in March. So maybe after I get back.
Okay.
Hello?
Yeah. I'm trying to wrap up, and you just dropped.
I know. I dropped them. I'm going to Germany. I'm going to teach them how to write sitcoms there. It's my revenge for World War II.
Well, we're teaching the Germans how to write sitcoms, and they're teaching us how to have a 1,000-year Reich.
Yeah.
With Trump.
Exactly.
Okay. I love you. Thank you, buddy.
All right. Hey, love the show. Talk soon.
Okay. Bye.
All right. Keep up the good work. Bye.
Bye. Should we wrap up the show?
Yeah, let's wrap it up.
How long? We went too long today, right?
Over 3 hours.
Okay. Micah Fox had a migraine. She wouldn't come on.
Aww.
Migraine is really code for, I don't think so. Do you ever use a migraine?
Yes, I have, but I also do genuinely get them. See, I'm one of those people who I can't be. I have to have some genuineness to my bullshit artistry.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, I would never use something that I've never actually gotten before.
So,
but I do get migraines.
Let's plug some stuff here before we wrap it up. Thank you guys for listening to the show, and we have a lot of new listeners.
Awesome.
We do. It's been pretty great. If you like today's show, please copy and paste the link and send it to all your friends. Please spread the word about this show. I think it's a pretty great show. We have pretty great guests,
mm-hmm. Yeah,
including
definitely.
Angela Cobb.
Thank you.
So all I ask is just tell people about this show any way possible. Just spread the word about this show because it's great. We have great guests. We really do. We really do. So just help us out here. Spread the word. I know it's a broken record, but, you know, whatever device you're listening to this show on, copy and paste it into an email and send it to all your friends. Post it on Facebook. Share it on Twitter. Stumble upon a friend of ours has a subreddit. For the life of me, I don't understand what that means.
Yeah, Reddit's
complicated. Are you on Reddit?
No, not really. Reddit's complicated.
Yeah.
It seems weird. I don't know. But it might. I guess you're saying it's been helpful to spread the word about the show. Or?
Yeah, that's what I'm
cool.
saying. Yeah,
yeah, awesome.
We have great guests. How can people help Angela Cobb? What should they do?
You can follow. You can follow me on Twitter at Angela Cobb, AngelaCobb. Follow me on Instagram at Angela Cobb Comedy, and you can like me on Facebook at Angela Cobb Comedy. And yeah, that would be helpful. This way, then you can see where I'm performing, and you can come out and check out different shows I'm on. You can also check out My First Time Show, which is the show that I host and produce at QED in Astoria, the third Wednesday of every month at 9 p.m. It features comics and storytellers telling virginity loss stories.
Who is a comic you've seen recently that's funny?
Chrissy Mayer.
Spell the name?
M-A-Y-R.
Chrissy Mayer.
Yeah, she's very funny.
Bring her next time.
Okay.
Will you?
I'd love to.
You'll come back?
Of course I'll come back.
From the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan, that'll do it for us.